Chapter Number 1 of Gullible's Travels, etc. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Gullible's Travels, etc. by Ring Lardner. Carmen. We was playing rummy over to Hatch's, and Hatch must have fell in a bed of four-leaf clovers on his way home the night before, because he plays rummy like he does everything else. But this night I refer to, you couldn't beat him. And besides him having all the luck, my missus played like she'd been bought off. So when we came to settle up, we was playing 7½ out. You know who paid it. So Hatch says, "There must be some game you can play." "No," I says, "not and beat you. I can run 2 blocks while you're stooping over to start. But if we was running a foot race between each other, and suppose I was leading by 80 yards, a flivver would probably come up and hit you in the back and bump you over the finishing line ahead of me." So Mrs. Hatch thinks I'm sore on account of the 750, so she says, "It don't seem fair for us to have all the luck." "Sure it's fair," I says. "If you didn't have the luck, what would you have?"
"I know," she says, "but I don't ever feel right winning money at cards."
"I don't blame you," I says.
"I know," she says, "but it seems like we should ought to give it back or else stand treat either one."
"Jim's too old to change all his habits," I says.
"Oh, well," says Mrs. Hatch, "I guess if I told him to loosen up, he'd loosen up. I ain't lived with him all these years for nothing."
"You'd be a sucker if you did," I says. So they all laughed, and when they'd quieted down, Mrs. Hatch says,
"I don't suppose you'd feel like taking the money back."
"Not without a gun," I says. "Jim's pretty husky." So that gave him another good laugh. But finally she says,
"What do you say, Jim, to us taking the money they lose to us and getting 4 tickets to some show?"
Jim managed to stay conscious, but he couldn't answer nothing. So my missus says,
"That'd be grand of you to do it, but don't think you got to."
Well, of course, Mrs. Hatch knowed all the while she didn't have to, but from what my missus says, she could tell that if they really gave us the invitation, we wouldn't start no fight. So they talked it over between themselves while I and Hatch went out in the kitchen and split a pint of beer, and Hatch done the pourin', and his best friend couldn't say he gave himself the worst of it. So when we come back, my missus and Mrs. Hatch had it all framed that the Hatches was going to take us to a show, and the next thing was what show it would be. So Hatch found the afternoon paper that somebody'd left on the streetcar and read us off a list of the shows that was in town. I spoke for the Columbia, but the missus gave me the sign to stay out. So they argued back and forth, and finally Mrs. Hatch says,
"Let's see that paper a minute."
"What for?" says Hatch. "I didn't hold nothing out on you." But he gave her the paper, and she run through the list herself, and then she says,
"You did, too, hold out on us. You didn't say nothing about the auditorium."
"What could I say about it?" says Hatch. "I never was inside."
"It's time you was, then,"
said Mrs. Hatch. "What's playing there?" I says.
"Grand Opera," says Mrs. Hatch.
"Oh," says my missus,
"wouldn't that be wonderful?"
"What do you say?" says Mrs. Hatch to me. "I think it'd be grand for you girls," I says. "I and Jim could leave you there and go down on Madison and see Charlie Chaplin and then come back after you."
"Nothing doing," says Mrs. Hatch. "We'll pick a show that everybody wants to see."
Well, if I hadn't looked at my missus then, we'd have been okay. But my eyes happened to light on where she was settin', and she was chewing her lips so she wouldn't cry. That finished me.
"I was just kiddin'," I says to Mrs. Hatch. "They ain't nothin' I like better than grand opera."
"Nothin' except gettin' trimmed in a rummy game," says Hatch, but he didn't get no rise. Well, the missus let loose of her lips so she could smile, and her and Mrs. Hatch got all excited, and I and Hatch pretended like we was excited, too. So Hatch asked what night could we go, and Mrs. Hatch says that depended on what did we want to hear, because they changed the bill every day.
So her and the missus looked at the paper again and found out where Friday night was going to be a big special night, and the bill was a musical show called Carmen, and all the stars was going to sing, including Muratori and Alda and Genevieve Farrar, that was in the movies a while till they found out she could sing, and some fella they called Daddy, but I don't know his real name. So the girls both says Friday night was the best, but Hatch says he would have to go to Lodge that evening. "Lodge," says Mrs. Hatch. "What do you care about Lodge when you get a chance to see Genevieve Farrar in Carmen?" "Chance," says Hatch. "If that's what you call a chance, I got a chance to buy 1,000 shares of Bethlehem Steel. Who's going to pay for my chance?" "All right," says Mrs. Hatch. "Go to your old Lodge and spoil everything." So this time it was her that choked up and made like she was going to blubber. So Hatch changed his mind all of a sudden and decided to disappoint the brother owls. So all of us was satisfied except 50%, and I and the missus beat it home, and on the way she says how nice Mrs. Hatch was to give us this treat. "Yes," I says, "but if you hadn't had a regular epidemic of discarding deuces and trays, Hatch would have treated us to groceries for a week." I says, "I always thought they was only 12 picture cards in the deck till I see them hands you saved up tonight." "You lose as much as I did," she says. "Yes," I says, "and I always will as long as you forget to fetch your purse along." So there wasn't no comeback to that. So we went on home without no more dialogue. Well, Mrs. Hatch called up the next night and says Jim had the tickets boughten, and we was to be sure and ready at 7 o'clock Friday night, because the show started at 8. So when I was downtown Friday, the missus sent my evening dress suit over to Katz's and had it pressed up, and when I come home, it was laid out on the bed like a corpse. "What's that for?" I says. "For the opera," she says. "Everybody wears them to the opera." "Did you ask the Hatches what they was going to wear?" I says. "No," says she. "They know what to wear without me telling them. They ain't going to the auditorium in their nightgown." So I clumb into the soup and fish, and the missus spent about an hour putting on a dress that she could have left off without nobody knowing the difference. And she didn't have time for no supper at all. And I just managed to surround a piece of steak as big as your eye and spill some gravy on my clothes when the bell rung, and there was the Hatches. Well, Hatch didn't have no more evening dress suit on than a cupie. I could see his pants under his overcoat, and they was the same old bay pants he wore the day he got mad at his kid and christened him Kenneth. And his shoes was a last year's edition of the kind that's supposed to give your feet a chance. And if his feet had been the kind that takes chances, they was two or three places where they could have got away without much trouble. I could tell from the expression on Mrs. Hatch's face when she seen our makeup that we'd crossed her. She looked about as comfortable as a Belgian. "Oh," she says, "I didn't think you'd dress up." "We thought you would," says my Frau. "We?" I says, "where do you get that we?" "If it ain't too late, we'll run in and change," says my missus. "Not me," I says. "I didn't go to all this trouble and expense for a splash of gravy. When this here uniform retires, it'll be to make room for pajamas." "Come on," says Hatch. "What's the difference? You can pretend like you ain't with us."
"It don't really make no difference," says Mrs. Hatch,
and maybe it didn't. But we all stood within whispering distance of each other on the car going in, and if you had a dollar for every word that was talked among us, you wouldn't mail a postcard from Hammond to Gary. When we got off at Congress, my missus tried to thaw out the party.
"The prices is awful high, aren't they?" she says. "Outrageous," says Mrs. Hatch.
Well, even if the prices was awful high, they didn't have nothing on our seats. If I was in training to be a steeplejack, I'd go to Grand Opera every night and leave Hatch by my ticket. And where he took us, I'd have been more at home in overalls and a sport shirt. "How do you like Denver?" says I to the missus, but she'd sank for the third time. "We're safe here," I says to Hatch. "Them French guns can't never reach us. We ought to have brought more bums." "What did the seats cost?" I says to Hatch.
$150,
he says.
"Very reasonable," says I. "One of them aviators wouldn't take you more than half this height for a 5-spot.
The Hatches had their overcoats off by this time, and I got a look at their full costume. Hatch had went without his vest during the hot months, and when it was alongside his coat and pants, it looked like two different families.
He had a pink shirt with prune-colored horizontal bars and a tie to match his neck, and a collar that would have took care of him and I both, and them shoes I told you about, and burlap hosiery. There wasn't nothing the matter with Mrs. Hatch, except she must have thought that instead of dressing for the opera, she was getting ready for Kenneth's bath. And there was my missus, just within the law, and me all spicked and spanned with my soup and fish and gravy. Well, we all sat there and tried to get the focus till about a half hour after the show was billed to commence, and finally a Lilliputian with a match in his hand come out and started up the orchestry, and they played a few of the hits, and then the lights was turned out, and up went the curtain. Well, sir, you'd be surprised at how good we could hear and see after we got used to it. But the hearing didn't do us no good, that is, the words part of it. All the actors had been smuggled in from Europe, and they wasn't one of them that could talk English. So all their songs was gave in different languages, and I wouldn't have never knew what was going on, only for Hatch having all the nerve in the world. After the first act, a lady that was sitting in front of us dropped something, and Hatch stooped over and picked it up, and it was one of these here books they call a libretto, and it's got all the words they're singing on the stage wrote out in English. So the lady began looking all over for it, and Hatch was going to give it back because he thought it was a shoe catalog, but he happened to see at the top where it says, price 25 cents. So he tossed it in his lap and stuck his hat over it. And the lady kept looking and looking, and finally she turned around and looked Hatch right in the eye. But he dropped down inside his collar and left her wear herself out. So when she give up, I says something about, I'd like to have a drink. Let's go, says Hatch. No, I says, I don't want it bad enough to go back to town after it. I thought maybe we could get it sent up to the room. I'm going alone then, says Hatch. You're liable to miss the second act, I says. I'll never miss it, says Hatch. All right, says I. I hope you have good weather. So he slipped me the book to keep for him and beat it. So I seen the lady had forgot us, and I opened up the book, and that's how I came to find out what the show was about. I read her all through, the part that was in English, before the curtain went up again. So when the second act began, I knowed what had come off and what was coming off, and Hatch and Mrs. Hatch hadn't no idea if the show was comical or dry. My missus hadn't either, till we got home, and I told her the plot. Carmen ain't no regular musical show, where a couple of yids comes out and pulls a few lines of dialogue, and then a girl and a he-flirt sings a song that ain't got nothing to do with it. Carmen's a regular play, only instead of them saying the lines, they sing them, and in foreign languages, so's the actors can pick up some loose change off'n the sale of the librettos. The music was wrote by George S. Bizzy, and it must have kept him that way about 2 months. The words was either throwed together by the stage carpenter or else took down by a stenographer outdoors during a drizzle. Anyway, they ain't nobody claims 'em. Every once in 3 or 4 pages they forget themselves and rhyme. You got to read each verse over 2 or 3 times before you learn what they're hinting at, but the management gives you plenty of time to do it between acts and still sneak a couple hours of sleep. The first act opens up somewheres in Spain, about the corner of Chicago Avenue and Wells. On one side of the stage there's a pill mill, where the employees is all girls, or was girls a few years ago. On the other side there's a soldier's garage, where they keep the militia in case of a strike. In the back of the stage there's a bridge, but it ain't over no water nor no railroad tracks or nothing. It's probably something the cat dragged in. Well, the soldier stands out in front of the garage, hitting up some barber shops, and pretty soon a girl blows in from the hero's hometown, Janesville or somewheres. She runs a few steps every little while and then stops like the rails was slippery. The soldier sings at her, and she tells them she's come to look for Don Joss that run the chop suey dump up to Janesville. But when they shut down on him serving beer, he quit and joined the army. So the soldiers never heard of the bird, but they all ask her if they wouldn't do just as good. But she says nothing doing and skids off the stage. She ain't no sooner gone when the Chinaman from Janesville and some more soldiers and some alley rats comes in to help out the singing. The book says this new gang of soldiers was sent in to relieve the others, but if anything happened to wear out the first ones, it must have took place at rehearsal. Well, one of the boys tells Joss about the girl asking for him, and he says, oh yes, that must be the little Michaels girl from up in Wisconsin.
So pretty soon the whistle blows for noon, and the girls come out of the pill mill smoking up the morning receipts, and a crowd of the unemployed comes in to shoot the snipes. So the soldiers notices that Genevieve Farrar ain't on yet. So they ask where she's at, and that's her cue. She puts on a song number and a Spanish dance, and then she slips her bouquet to the chink, though he ain't sang a note since the whistle blowed. But now it's 1 o'clock, and Genevieve and the rest of the girls beats it back to the coffin factory, and the Vagues chases down to the Loop to get the last home edition and look at the want ads to see if there's any jobs open with fair pay and nothing to do. And the soldiers mosey into the garage for a well-earned rest, and that leaves Don all alone on the stage. But he ain't no more than started on his next song when back comes the Michaels girl. It oozes out here that she's in love with the Joss party, but she stalls and pretends like his mother'd sent her to get the receipt for making eggs foo young. And she says his mother asked her to kiss him, and she slips him a dime, so he leaves her kiss him on the scalp, and he asks her if she can stay in town that evening and see a nickel show. But there's an important meeting of the Maccabees at Janesville that night, so away she goes to catch the 2:10, and Don starts in on another song number. But the rest of the company don't like his stuff, and he ain't hardly past the vamp when there's a riot. It seems like Genevieve and one of the chorus girls has quarreled over a second-hand stick of gum, and the chorus girl got the gum, but Genevieve relieved her of part of an earlobe. So they pinch Genevieve and leave Joss to watch her until the wagon comes. But the wagons went out to the night desk sergeant's house with a case of quartz, and before it gets around to pick up Genevieve, she's bunked the chink into setting her free. So she makes a getaway, telling Don to meet her later on at Lillian Pat's place across the Indiana line. So that winds up the first act. Well, the next act's out to Lillian Pat's, and it ain't no YMCA headquarters, but it's a hangout for dips and policemans. They's a cabaret, and Genevieve's one of the performers, but she forgets the words to her first song and winds up with tra-la-la. And she could have forgot the whole song, as far as I'm concerned, because it wasn't nothing you'd want to buy and take along home. Finally, Pat comes in and says it's 1 o'clock and he's got to close up. But they won't none of them make a move, and pretty soon there's a live one blows into the joint, and he's Eskimo Bill, one of the butchers out to the yards. He's got paid that day, and he ain't never going home. He sings a song, and it's the hit of the show. Then he buys a drink and starts flirting with Genevieve, but Pat chases everybody but the performers and a couple of dips that ain't got nowheres else to sleep. The dips, or stick-up guys, or whatever they are, tries to get Genevieve to go along with them in the car while they pull off something, but she's still expecting the Chinaman. So they pass her up and blow, and along comes Don, and she lets him in, and it seems like he'd been in jail for 2 months, or ever since the end of the first act. So he asks her how everything has been down to the pill mill, and she tells him that she's quit and become an entertainer. So he says, "What can you do?" And she beats time with a pair of chopsticks and dances the Chinese blues. After a while, there's a bugle call somewhere outdoors, and Don says that means he's got to go back to the garage. So she gets sore and tries to bean him with a Spanish onion. Then he reaches inside his coat and pulls out the bouquet she gave him in Eto First to show her he ain't changed his clothes, and then the sheriff comes in and tries to coax him with a razor to go back to his job. They fight like it was the first time either of them ever tried it, and the sheriff's leading on points when Genevieve hollers for the dips, who dashes in with their gats pulled, and it's good night, Mr. Sheriff. They put him in mothballs, and they ask Joss to join their tong. He says, "All right." And they're all pretty well lit by this time, and they've reached the singing stage, and Pat can't get them to go home, and he's scared some of the Hammond people will put in a complaint, so he has the curtain rang down. Then there's a relapse of it don't say how long, and Don and Genevieve and the Yeggs and their lady friends is all out in the country somewheres, attending a bohunk, so-called Verein picnic, and Don starts whining about his old lady that he'd left up to Janesville. "I wished I was back there," he says. "You got nothing on me," says Genevieve, "only Janesville ain't far enough. I wished you was back in Hong Kong." So while they're flattering each other back and forth, a couple of the girls is monkeying with the pasteboards and telling their fortunes, and one of them turns up a two-spot,
and that's a sign they're going to sing a duet. So it comes true. And then Genevieve horns into the game, and they play three-handed rummy, singing all the while to bother each other. But finally the fellas that's running the picnic says it's time for the fat man's one-legged race, and everybody goes off on the stage. So the Michaels girl comes on and is getting by pretty good with a song when she's scared by the noise of the gun that's fired to start the race for the Bay Window Championship. So she trips back to her dressing room, and then Don and Eskimo Bill put on a little slapstick stuff. When they first meet, they're pals. But as soon as they get wise that the both of them's bugs over the same girl, their relations towards each other become strange. Here's the talk they spill. "Where do you tend bar?" says Don. "You got me guessed wrong," says Bill. "I work out to the yards." "Got anything on the hip?" says Don. "You took the words out of my mouth," says Bill. "I'm drier than St. Petersgrad." "Stick around a while, and maybe we can scare up something," says Don. "I'll stick all right," says Bill. "There's a Jane in your party that's knocked me dead." "What's her name?" says Don.
"Carmen," says Bill.
Carmen being the girl's name in the show that Genevieve was taking that part.
"Carmen," says Josh. "Get off on that stuff. I and Carmen's just like two paving bricks."
"I should worry," says Bill. "I ain't gonna run away from no rat-eater."
"You're a rat-eater yourself, you rat-eater," says Don.
"I'll rat-eat you," says Bill. And they go to it with a carving set, but they couldn't neither one of them handle their utensils. Don may have been all right slicing toadstools for the suey, and Bill probably could have massacred a flock of sheep with one stab, but they was all up in the air when it came to sticking each other. They'd have did it better with dice. Pretty soon the other actors can't stand it no longer, and they come on, yelling, "Fake!" So Don and Bill fold up their razors, and Bill invites the whole bunch to come out and go through the yard some morning, and then he beats it. And the Michaels girl ain't did nothing for 15 minutes, so the management shoots her out for another song, and she sings to Don about how he should ought to go home on account of his old lady being sick. So he asks Genevieve if she cares if he goes back to Janesville.
"Sure I care," says Genevieve. "Go ahead." So the act winds up with everybody satisfied.
The last act's outside the yards on the Halstead Street end. Bill's asked the entire company to come in and watch him croak a steer. The scene opens up with the crowd buying perfume and smelling salts from the guys that's got the concessions. Pretty soon, Eskimo Bill and Carmen drive in, all dressed up like a horse. Don's come in from Wisconsin and is hiding in the bunch. He's sore at Carmen for not meeting him on the elevated platform. He lays low until everybody went inside, only Carmen. Then he braces her. He tells her his old lady's died and left him the laundry, and he wants her to go in with him and do the ironing.
"Not me," she says.
"What do you mean, not me?" says Don.
"I and Bill's gonna run a kosher market," she says.
Just about now you can hear noises behind the scenes like the cattle's getting theirs, so Carmen don't want to miss none of it, so she makes a break for the gate.
"Where are you going?" says Joss.
"I want to see the butcherin," she says.
"Stick round, and I'll show you how it's done," says Joss.
So he pulls his knife and makes a pass at her, just fooling. He misses her as far as from here to Des Moines. But she don't know he's kidding, and she's scared to death. Yes, sir, she topples over as dead as the Federal League. It was probably her heart. So now the whole crowd comes dashing out because there's been a report that the place is infested with a hoof-and-mouth disease. They tell Don about it, but he's all excited over Carmen dying. He's delirious and gets himself mixed up with an Irish policeman.
"I yield me prisoner," he says.
Then the house doctor says the curtain's got to come down to prevent the epidemic from spreading to the audience. So the show's over, and the company's quarantined. Well, Hatch was out all during the second act and part of the third, and when he finally come back, he didn't have to tell nobody where he'd been, and he dozed off the minute he hit his seat. I was for letting him sleep so's the rest of the audience would think we had one of the opera bass singers in our party, but Mrs. Hatch wasn't looking for no publicity on account of her costume, so she reached over and prodded him with a hat pin every time he began a new aria. Going out, I says to him, "How'd you like it?"
"Pretty good," he says, "only there was too much gin in the last one."
"I mean the opera," I says.
"Don't ask him," says Mrs. Hatch. "He didn't hear half of it, and he don't understand none of it."
"Oh, I wouldn't say that," says I. "Jim here ain't no boob, and there wasn't nothing hard about it to understand."
"Not if you know the plot," says Mrs. Hatch.
"And something about music," says my missus. "And got a little knowledge of French," says Mrs. Hatch. "Was that French they was singing?" said Hatch. "I thought it was wop or ostrich."
"That shows you up," says his frau.
Well, when we got on the car for home, there wasn't only one vacant seat, and of course Hatch had to have that. So I and my missus and Mrs. Hatch clubbed together on the straps, and I got an earful of the real dope.
"What do you think of Farrar's costumes?" says Mrs. Hatch.
"Heavenly," says my missus.
"Especially the one in the second act. It was all the colors of the rainbow."
"Hatch is right in style, then," I says.
"And her acting is perfect," says Mrs. Hatch.
"Her voice, too," says the wife.
"I liked her actin' better," says Mrs. H. "I thought her voice yodeled in the upstairs registers."
"What do you suppose killed her?" I says.
"She was stabbed by her lover," says the missus.
"You wasn't looking," I says. "He never touched her. It was probably tobacco heart."
"He stabs her in the book," says Mrs. Hatch.
"It never went through the binding," I says.
"And wasn't muratory grand?" says the wife.
"Splendid," says Mrs. Hatch. "His actin' and singin' was both grand."
"I preferred his actin'," I says. "I thought his voice hissed in the downstairs radiators." This gave them a good laugh, but they was soon at it again.
"And how sweet Alda was,"
my missus remarks. "Which was her?" I asked them.
"The good girl," says Mrs. Hatch, "the girl that sung the beautiful aria in Otto III.
"Otto girl," I says. "I liked her, too, the little Michaels girl. She came from Janesville."
"She did," says Mrs. Hatch.
"How do you know?"
So I thought I'd kid him along. "My uncle told me," I says. "He used to be postmaster up there."
"What uncle was that?" says my wife.
"He ain't really my uncle," I says. "We all used to call him our uncle, just like all these here singers calls the one of them Daddy."
"There was a lady in back of me," says Mrs. Hatch, "that says Daddy didn't appear tonight."
"Probably the Mrs. Night Out," I says.
"How'd you like the Torridor?" says Mrs. Hatch.
"I thought she moaned in the chimney," says I.
"It wasn't no she," says the missus. "We're talking about the bullfighter."
"I didn't see no bullfight," I says.
"It came off behind the scenes," says the missus.
"When was you behind the scenes?" I says.
"I wasn't never," says my missus, "but that's where it's supposed to come off."
"Well," I says, "you can take it from me that it wasn't pulled. Do you think the mayor'd stand for that stuff when he won't even let him stage a box fight? You two girls has got a fine idea of this here opera."
"You know all about it, I guess," says the missus. "You talk French so good."
"I talk as much French as you do," I says, "but not nowheres near as much English, if you could call it that." That kept her quiet. But Mrs. Hatch buzzed all the way home, and she was scared to death that the motorman wouldn't know where she'd been spending the evening. And if there was anybody in the car besides me that knowed Carmen, it must have been a joke to them hearing her chatter. It wasn't no joke to me, though. Hatch's berth was way off from us, and they didn't nobody suspect him of being in our party. I was standing right up there with her, where people couldn't help seeing that we was together. I didn't want them to think she was my wife, so I kept smiling at her. And when it finally come time to get off, I hollered out loud at Hatch and says,
"All right, Hatch, here's our street. Your missus'll keep you awake the rest of the way with her libretto."
"It can't hurt no more than them hat pins," he says. Well, when the paper come the next morning, my missus had to grab it up and turn right away to the place where the operas is wrote up. Under the article there was a list of the ladies and gents in the boxes and what they wore, but it didn't say nothing about what the gents wore, only the ladies. Probably the ladies happened to have the most comical costumes that night, but I bet if the reporters could have saw Hatch, they would have given him a page to himself. "Is your name there?" I says to the missus.
"Of course not," she says. "There wasn't none of them reporters tall enough to see us. You got to set in a box to be mentioned."
"Well," I says, "you don't care nothing about being mentioned, do you?"
"Of course not," she says.
But I could tell from how she said it that she wouldn't run downtown and horsewhip the editor if he made a mistake and printed about she in her costume. Her costume wouldn't add up all the space he had, neither. "How much does box seats cost?" I asked her.
"About $6 or $7," she says.
"Well," I says, "let's I and you show Hatch up."
"What do you mean?" she says.
"I mean we should ought to return the compliment," says I. "We should ought to give them a party right back."
"We'd be broke for 6 weeks," she says.
"Oh, we'd do it with their money, like they done it with ours," I says.
"Yes," she says, "but if you can ever win enough from the Hatches to buy 4 box seats to the opera, I'd rather spend the money on a dress."
"Who said anything about 4 box seats?" I asked her.
"You did," she says.
"You're delirious," I says. 2 box seats will be a plenty."
"Who's to set in them?" asked the missus.
"Who do you think?" I says. "I and you is to set in them."
"But what about the Hatches?" she says.
"They'll set up where they was," says I. "Hatch picked out the seats before, and if he hadn't have wanted that altitude, he'd have bought somewheres else."
"Yes," says the missus. "But Mrs. Hatch won't think we're very polite to plant our guests in the Alps, and we set down on a box."
"But they won't know where we're settin'," I says. "We'll tell them we couldn't get 4 seats together, so for them to sit where they was last time, and we're goin' elsewheres."
"It don't seem fair," says my wife.
"I should worry about being fair with Hatch," I says. "If he's ever left with more than a dime's worth of cards, you got to look under the table for his hand."
"It don't seem fair," says the missus.
"You should worry," I says. So we asked him over the following night, and it looked for a minute like we was going to clean up. But after that 1 minute, my missus began collecting picture cards again, and every card Hatch drawed seemed like it was made to his measure. Well, sir, when we was through, the lucky stiff was $8 to the good, and Mrs. Hatch had about broke even. "Do you suppose you could get them same seats?" I says. "What seats?" says Hatch. "For the opera," I says. "You won't get me to no more opera," says Hatch. "I don't never go to the same show twice it." "It ain't the same show, you goof," I says. "They change the bill every day." "They ain't going to change this $8 bill of mine," he says. "You're a fine stiff," I says. "Call me anything you want to," says Hatch, "as long as you don't go over $8 worth."
"Jim don't enjoy opera," says Mrs. Hatch.
"He don't enjoy nothing that's more than a nickel," I says, "but as long as he's going to welch on us, I hope he lavishes the 8 spot where it'll do him some good." "I'll do what I want with it," says Hatch. "Sure you will," I says. "You'll bury it. But what you should ought to do is buy 2 suits of clothes." So I went out in the kitchen and split a pint one way. But don't think for a minute that I and the missus ain't going to hear no more opera, just because of a cheap stiff like him welching. I don't have to win in no rummy game before I spend. We're going next Tuesday night, I and the missus, and we're going to set somewhere near Congress Street. The show's Armor's Do-Re-Mi, a new one that's being gave for the first time. It's probably named after some soap. End of Carmen. Chapter 2 of Gullible's Travels, etc. by Ring Lardner. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. 3 Kings and a Pair. According to some authorities, a person before they get married should ought to look up your opponent's family tree and find out what all her relatives died of. But the way I got it figured out, if you're sure they did die, the rest of it don't make no difference. In exceptionable cases, it may be all right to take a girl that part of her family is still living, but not under no circumstances if the part happens to be an unmarried sister named Bessie. We was expecting her in about 2 weeks, but we got a card Saturday morning which she says on it that she'd come right away if it was all the same to us, because it was the dull season in Wabash society, and she could tear loose better at the present time than later on. Well, I guess there ain't no time in the year when society in Wabash would collapse for she not being there, but if she had to come at all, the sooner it was over, the better. And besides, it wouldn't have done us no good to say aye, yes, or no, because the postcard only beat her here by a few hours. Not having no idea she was coming so soon, I didn't meet the train, but it seems like she brought her escort right along with her. It was a guy named Bishop, and she'd met him on the trip up. The news butcher introduced them, I guess. He seen her safe to the house, and she was there when I got home. Her and my missus was full of him.
Just think, the missus says, he writes motion picture plays.
And gets $10,000 a year, says Bess.
Did you find out from the firm? I asked her.
He told me himself, says Bessie.
That's the right kind of fella, says I, open and above the board.
Oh, you like Mr. Bishop, says Bess. He says such funny things.
Yes, I says, that's a pretty good one about the $10,000 a year. But I suppose it's funnier when he tells it himself. I wished I could meet him.
There won't be no trouble about that, says the missus. He's coming to dinner tomorrow, and he's coming to play cards some evening next week.
What evening, I says.
Any evening that's convenient for you, says Bessie.
Well, I says, I'm sorry, but I got engagements every night except Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
What about Tuesday? Asked Bessie.
We're going to the opera, I says.
Oh, won't that be grand, says Bessie. I wonder what I can wear.
Oh, come on, it'd be all right, I says. If the doorbell rings, you don't have to answer it.
What do you mean? Says the missus. I guess if we go, Bess'll go with us.
You'll starve to death if you guessed for a living, I says.
Never mind that kind of talk, says the missus. When we got a visitor, we're not going out places nights and leave her here alone.
What's the matter with Bishop? I says. There's a lot of two-handed card games.
I ain't going to force myself on to you,
says Bessie.
You don't have to take me nowheres if you don't want to.
I wish you'd put that in writing in case of a lawsuit, I says.
Listen here, says the Frau. Get this straight. Either Bess goes or I don't go.
You can both stay home, says I. I don't anticipate no trouble finding a partner.
All right, that's settled, says the missus. We'll have a party of our own.
And it must have been going to be a dandy, because just speaking about it made her cry. So I says, you win, but I'll probably have to change the tickets.
What kind of tickets have you got?
Asked the missus. Cheap ones, I says, downstairs, 5 per.
How grand, says Bessie.
Yes, I says, but I'm afraid I got the last 2 they had. I'll probably have to give 'em back and take 3 balcony seats.
That's all right, just so Bess goes, says the wife. Mr. Bishop's wild about music, says Bessie.
Well, I says, he probably gets passes to the picture houses.
He don't hear no real music there, says Bessie.
Well, says I, suppose when he comes tomorrow, I mention something about I and the missus having tickets to the opera Tuesday night. Then if he's so wild about music, he'll maybe try to horn into the party and split the expenses 50-50.
That'd be a fine thing, says the Frau. He'll think we was a bunch of cheapskates. Come right out and ask him to go at your expense, or else don't ask him at all.
I won't ask him at all, I says. It was a mistake for me ever to suggest it.
Yes, says Bessie, but after making the suggestion, it would be a mean trick not to go through with it.
Why, I asked her, he won't never know the difference.
But I will, says Bessie. Of course you would, dear, says the missus. After thinking you was going to have a man of your own, the party wouldn't seem like no party if you just went along with us.
All right, I says. Let's not argue no more. Every time I open my head, it costs $3.
No such a thing, says the missus. The whole business won't only be $2 more than you figured on. The tickets you had for the 2 of us would come to $10, and with Bess and Mr. Bishop gone, it's only 12 if you get balcony seats. I wonder, says Bessie, if Mr. Bishop wouldn't object to sitting in the balcony.
Maybe he would, says the missus.
Well, I says, if he gets dizzy and falls over the railings, there's plenty of ushers to point out where he came from.
"'They ain't no danger of him getting dizzy,' says Bessie. "'The only thing is he's probably used to settin' in the high-priced seats "'and would be embarrassed among the riff and raff.'
"'He can wear a false mustache for a disguise.'
"'He's got a real one,' says Bessie.
"'He can shave it off, then,' says I.
"'I wouldn't have him do that for the world,' says Bessie. "'It's too nice a one.'
"'You can't judge a mustache by seeing it once,' I say. "'It may be a crook at heart.'
"'This ain't getting us nowhere,' says the missus. "'They's still a question before the house.'
"'It's up to Bess to give the answer,' I says. "'Bishop and his lip shield are invited, if they'll set in a $3 seat.'
"'It's off, then,' says Bessie, and beats it in the guest room and slams the door. "'What's the matter with you?' says the missus.
"'Nothing at all,' I says, "'except I ain't no millionaire scenario writer. $20 is $20.'
"'Yes,' says the missus, "'but how many times have you lost more than that playing cards and not thought nothing of it?'
"'That's different,' I says. "'When I spend money in a card game, it's more like an investment. "'I get a chance to make something by it.'
"'And this would be an investment, too,' says the wife, "'and a whole lot better chance of winning than in one of them crooked card games.'
"'What are you getting at?' I asked her.
"'This is what I'm getting at,' she says. "'Though you'd ought to see it without me telling you. "'This here bishop's made a big hit with Bess.'
"'It's been done before,' says I.
"'Listen to me,' says the frau. "'It's high time she was getting married, "'and I don't want her marrying none of them Hoosier hicks.'
"'They'll see to that,' I says. "'They ain't such hicks.'
"'She can do a lot worse than take this here bishop,' the missus says. "'$10,000 a year ain't no small change, "'and she'll be here and shy.' Maybe they could find a flat right in this building.
That's all right, I says. We could move.
Don't be so smart, says the missus. It would be mighty nice for me to have her so near, and it would be nice for you and I both to have a rich brother-in-law.
I don't know about that, says I. Somebody might do us a mischief in a fit of jealous rage.
He'd show us enough good times to make up for whatever they done, says the wife. "'We're foolish if we don't make no play for him, "'and it'd be starting off right to take him along to this here opera "'and set him in the best seats. "'He likes good music, and you can see he's used to doing things in style. "'And besides, Sis looks her best when she's dressed up.'
"'Well, I finally gave in, and the missus called Bessie out of the despondence ward, "'and they were all smiles and pep. "'But they acted like I wasn't in the house. "'So to make it realistic, I blowed down to Andy's "'and looked after some of my other investments. "'We always have dinner Sundays at 1 o'clock. "'But of course Bishop didn't know that "'and showed up prompt at 10 bells "'before I was halfway through the comical section. "'I had to go to the door "'because the missus don't ever put on her shoes "'till she's positive the family on the first floor is all awake, "'and Bessie was basking in the kind of water "'that don't come in your lease at Wabash.'
"'Mr. Bishop, ain't it?'
I says, looking him straight in the upper lip.
"'How'd you know?' he says, smiling.
"'The girls told me to be expecting a handsome man of that name,' I says, "'and they told me about the mustache. "'There wouldn't be much to tell,' says Bishop. "'It's young yet,' I says. "'Come in and take a weight off your feet.' "'So he picked out the only chair we got that ain't upholstered with flat irons, "'and we sat down and was trying to think of something more to say "'when Bessie hollered to us from mid-channel.
"'Is that Mr. Bishop?'
she yelped. "'It's me, Miss Gordon,' says Bishop.
"'I'll be right out,' says Bess.
"'Take it easy,' I says. "'You mightn't catch cold, but there's no use risking it.' So then I and Bishop knocked the streetcar service and President Wilson and gave each other the double O. He wasn't what you call ugly-looking, but if he'd come out in print and say he was handsome, a good lawyer'd have you at his mercy. His dimensions, what they was of them, all run perpendicular. He didn't have no latitude. If his collar slipped over his shoulders, he could step out of it. If they hadn't been paying him all them millions for picture plays, he could have got a job in a wire wheel. They wouldn't have been no difference in his photograph if you took it with an X-ray or a camera. But he had hair and two eyes and a mouth and all the rest of it, and his clothes was certainly class. Why wouldn't they be? He could pick out cloth that was $30 a yard and get a suit and overcoat for $15. An umbrella cover would have made him a year's pajamas. Well, I seen the missus sneak from the kitchen to her room to don the shoe leather, so I got right down to business. "The girls tell me you're fond of good music," I says. "I love it," says Bishop. "Do you ever take in the opera?" I asked him. "I eat it up," he says. "Have you been this year?" I says. "Pretty near every night," says Bishop. "I should think you'd be sick of it," says I. "Oh, no," he says, "no more than I get tired of food." "A man could easily get tired of the same kind of food," I says. "But the operas is all different," says Bishop. "Different languages, maybe," I says, "but they're all music and singing." "Yes," says Bishop, "but the music and singing in the different operas is no more alike than lumbago and hives. They couldn't be nothing differenter, for instance, than Faust and Madame Buttermilk." "Unless it was scotch and chocolate soda," I says. "They's good operas and bad operas," says Bishop. "Which is the good ones?" I asked him. "Oh," he says, "Carmen and La Bohemian Girl and Il Toreador." "Carmen's a bear cat," I says. "If they was all good as Carmen, I'd go every night. But lots of 'em is flivvers. They say they couldn't nothing be worse than this Armour's D. Tree Re." "It is pretty bad," says Bishop. "I seen it a year ago." "Well, I'd just been reading in the paper where it was brand new and hadn't never been given previous to this season, so I thought I'd have a little sport with Mr. Smartenstein." "What's it about?" I says. He stalled a while. "It ain't about much of anything," he says. "It must be about something," says I. "They got it all balled up the night I seen it," says Bishop. "The actors forgot their lines, and a man couldn't make heads nor tails of it." "Did they sing in English?" I asked him. "No, Latin," says Bishop. "Can you understand Latin?" I says. "Sure," says he. "I ought to. I studied it 2 years." "What's the name of it mean in English?" I asked. "You pronounce the Latin wrong," he says. "I can't parse it from how you say it. If I'd seen it wrote out, I could tell." So I handed him the paper where they give the opera schedule. "That's her," I says, pointing to the one that was billed for Tuesday night. "Oh, yes," says Bishop. "Yes, that's the one." "No question about that," says I. "But what's it mean?" "I knowed you'd said it wrong," says Bishop. "The right pronouncement would be L. Armour's Day Tray Ray." No wonder I was puzzled. "Now the puzzle's solved," I says. "What do them last three words mean? Louis Armour's what?" Ain't got nothing to do with armor," says Bishop. "The first word is the Latin for love, and day means of God, and tray means three, and ray means kings." "Oh," I says, "it's a poker game. The fellow's just called, and the other fellow shows down his hand, and the first fellow had a straight and thought it was no good. So he's surprised to see what the other fellow's got. So he says, 'Well, for the love of Mike, three kings, only makes it stronger.' Is that the dope?" "I don't think it's anything about poker," says Bishop. "You'd ought to know," I says. "You seen it." "But it was all jumbled up," says Bishop. "I couldn't get the plot." "Do you suppose you could get it if you seen it again?" I says. "I wouldn't sit through it," he says. "It's no good." "Well, sir, I thought at the time that this little speech meant a saving of $8, because if he didn't go along, us three could set amongst the riff and raff. I dropped the subject right there and was going to tell the girls about it when he'd went home, but the missus crabbed it a few minutes after her, and Bess came in the room. 'Did you get your invitation?' says she to Bishop. 'What invitation?' he says. 'My husband was going to ask you to go with us Tuesday night,' she says. 'Grand Opera.' 'Bishop won't go,' I says. 'He's already saw the play and says it ain't no good, and he wouldn't feel like setting through it again.'
"'Why, Mr. Bishop, that's a terrible disappointment,' says the missus. "'We was counting on you,' says Bessie, choking up.
"'It's tough luck,' I says, "'but you can't expect things to break right all the while.'
"'Wouldn't you change your mind?' says the missus.
"'That's up to your husband,' says Bishop. "'I didn't understand that I was invited. "'I should certainly hate to break up a party. "'And if I'd knew I was going to be asked, "'I would have spoke different about the opera. "'It's probably a whole lot better than when I seen it, "'and besides, I would surely enjoy your company.' You can enjoy ourn most any night for nothing, I says, but if you don't enjoy the one down to the auditorium, there's no use in me paying 5 iron men to have you bored to death. You got me wrong, says Bishop. The piece was gave by a bunch of supers the time I went. I'd like to see it with a real cast. They say it's a whiz when it's acted right.
There, says the missus, that settles it. You can change the tickets tomorrow.
So I was stopped, and there was no more to say. And after a while we had dinner, and then I see why Bishop was so skinny. Apparently he hadn't tasted fodder before for a couple of months. It must keep you busy writing them scenarios, I says. No time to eat or nothing. Oh, I eat once in a while, even if I don't look it, he says. I don't often get a chance at food that's cooked like this. Your wife's some dandy little cook.
It runs in a family, I guess, says Bessie. You ought to taste my cooking.
Maybe he will some day, says the missus. And then her and Bessie pretended like they'd made a break and was embarrassed. So when he was through, I says, leave best take Bishop out in the kitchen and show him how she can wash dishes.
Nothing doing, says the wife. I'm going to stack them, and then I and you's got to hurry and keep our date.
What date, I says?
Over to Hatches, says the missus. You ain't forgotten, had you?
I ain't forgotten that the Hatches was in Benton Harbor, I says.
Yes, says the Frau, winking at me. But I promised Mrs. Hatch I'd run over there and see that everything was okay.
So I wasn't even allowed to sit down and smoke, but had to help unload the table and then go out into the cold. And it was rotten weather and Sunday and nothing but water, water everywhere. What's the idea? I asked the missus when we was out.
Can't you see nothing? She says. I want to give Bess a chance.
Chance to what? I says.
A chance to talk to him, says the wife.
Oh, says I. I thought you wanted him to get stuck on her.
What do you think of him? Says she. Wouldn't he fit fine in the family?
He'd fit in a flute, I says. He's the skinniest thing I ever seen. It seems like a shame to pay $5 for a seat for him when him and Bessie could sit in the same seat without contact.
He is slender, says the missus. Probably they've been starving him where he boards at.
I bet they wouldn't starve me on $10,000 a year, I says. But maybe they don't know he's at the table or think he's just one of the macaroni.
It's all right for you to make jokes about him, says she. But if you had his brains, we'd be better off.
If I had his brains, I said, he'd go up like a balloon. If he lost an ounce, gravity wouldn't have no effect on him.
You don't have to bulge out to be a man, says the missus. He's smart, and he's rich, and he's a swell dresser, and I don't think we'd find a better match for Bess.
Match just describes him, says I.
You're too cute to live, says the wife. But no matter what you say, him and Bess is going to hit it off. They're just suited to each other. They're an ideal pair.
You win that argument, I says. They're a pair, all right, and they'd make a great hand if you was playing deuces wild. Well, we walked around till our feet was froze, and then we went home. And Bishop says he would have to go, but the missus asked him to stay to supper. And when he made the remark about having to go, he was referring to 1 o'clock the next morning. And right after supper, I was gave the choice of taking another walk or hitting the hay.
Why don't we play cards, I says. It's Sunday, says the missus.
Has the mayor stopped that, too? I says.
But she winked at me again, the old flirt,
so I stuck around the kitchen till it was pretty near time to wipe the dishes, and then I went to bed. Monday noon, I chased over to the auditorium, and there was only about 80 in line ahead of me, and I was hoping the house would be sold out for a week before I got up to the window. While I was marking time, I looked at the pictures of the different actors hung up on the post to advertise some kind of hair tonic. I wished I had Bishop along to tell me what the different names meant in English. I suppose most of them meant goatee or spinach or brush or hedge or thicket or something. Then there was the girls' pictures, too. Genevieve Farrar, that died in the stockyard scene in Carmen, and Fanny Alda, that took the part of the Michaels girl from Janesville, and Mary Gardner, and Louise Edvany, that was going to warble for us, and a lot more of all ages and one size. Finally, I got up to the ticket agent's cage,
and then I didn't only have to wait till the three women behind me done their shopping, and then I hauled out my two tickets and asked the agent what would he give me for them. "Do you want to exchange them?" he says. "I did," says I, "but I heard you was sold out for tomorrow night." "Oh, no," he says, "we got plenty of seats." "But nothing downstairs, is they?" I says. "Yes," he says, "anywhere as you want." "Well," I says, "if you're sure you can spare them, I want four in the place of these two." "Here's four nice ones in the seventh row," says he. "It'll be $10 more." "I ain't particular to have 'em nice," I says. "It don't make no difference," says he. "The whole downstairs is five a wallop." "Yes," I says, "but one of the four that's going is a little skinny feller, and another's a refugee from Wabash." "I don't care if they're all escapades from Milford Junction," he says. "We ain't running no Hoosier Welfare League." "You're smart, ain't you?" I says. "I got to be," says the agent. "But if you was a little smarter, you'd be this side of the cage instead of that side," says I. "Do you want these tickets or don't you?" he says. So I seen he didn't care for no more verbal collisions with me, so I gave him the two tickets and a bonus of $10, and he gave me back four pasteboards and throwed in an envelope free for nothing. I passed up lunch Tuesday because I wanted to get home early and have plenty of time to dress. That was the idea, and it worked out every bit as successful as the peace ship. In the first place, I couldn't get in my room because that's where the Mrs. and Bess was making up. In the second place, I didn't need to have allowed any time for supper because there was none. The wife said she and Bessie had been so busy with their clothes that they'd forgot a little thing like supper. "But I didn't have no lunch," I says.
"That ain't my fault," says the Mrs. "Besides, we can all go somewheres and eat after the show."
"On who?" I says.
"You're giving the party," says she.
"The invitations didn't contain no clause about the inner man," says I. "Furthermore, if I'd had the $10 back that I spent today for tickets, I'd have $11 altogether."
"Well," says the missus, "maybe Mr. Bishop will have the hunch."
"He will if his hearing's good," says I. Bishop showed up at 6:30, looking mighty cute in his waiter uniform. After he'd come, it didn't take Bess long to finish her toilet. I like to fell over when I see her. Some doll she was, too, in a 50-meg evening dress marked down to 37. I know, because I'd help pick it out for the missus. "My, you look sweet," says Bishop. "That's a beautiful gown."
"It's my favorite," says Bessie.
"It don't take a person long to get attached to a pretty dress," I says. The missus hollered for me to come in and help her.
"I don't need no help," she says, "but I didn't want you giving no secrets away."
"What are you going to wear?" says I.
"Bess had one that just fits me," she says. "She's loaning it to me."
"Her middle name's Generous," I says.
"Don't be sarcastical," says the missus. "I want Sis to look her best this once."
"And I suppose it don't make no difference how you look," says I, "so long as you only get me to please. If Bishop's friends see him with Bessie, they'll say, 'My, he's copped out a big leaguer.' But if I run into any of my pals, they'll think I married the hired girl."
"You should worry," says the missus.
"And besides that," I says, "if you succeed in tying Bishop up to a long-term lease, he's bound to see that there dress on you sometime, and then what'll he think?"
"Bess can keep the gown," says the missus. "I'll make her give me one of hern for it."
"With your trading ability," I says, "you ought to be the Cincinnati Reds manager. But if you do give the dress to her," I says, "warn her not to wear it in Wabash, except when the marshal's over on the other street." Well, we was ready in a few minutes, because I'm getting used to the soup and fish, and everything went on easy, owing to my vacuum, and I was too weak to shave. And the missus didn't have no trouble with Bessie's creation, which was built like the Cottage Grove cars, enter at front.
"I don't think I'm so bad," says the missus, looking in the glass.
"You'd be just right," I says, "if we was going to the annual meeting of the Woman's Guild." I and Bishop had a race getting on the streetcar. I was first, and he won. "I just got paid today," he says, "and I didn't have time to get change." There wasn't only one seat. Bess took it first, and then offered it to the missus.
"I'll be mad at you if you don't take it," says Bess.
But the wife remained standing, and Bessie, by a great effort, kept her temper. Going into the theater, we passed a fellow that was selling librettos. "I bet this guy's got lots of change," I says. "Them things is for people who ain't never saw no opera," says Bishop. "I'm going to have one," I says. "Don't buy none for me," says Bishop. "You just spoke in time," I says. I laid down a quarter and grabbed one of the books.
"It's 35 cents," says the guy.
"Carmen wasn't only a quarter," I says. "Is this show better than Carmen?" "This is a new one," the guy says. "This fella," I says, pointing to Bishop, "seen it a year ago." "He must have a good imagination," says the guy. "No," I says, "he writes moving picture plays." I gave up an extra dime because there didn't seem to be nothing else to do. Then I handed over my tickets to the fellow at the door, and we was took right down amongst the high polli. Say, I thought the dress Bess was wearing was low. Ought to have been, seeing it was cut down from $50 to 37. But the rest of the gowns round us must have been 60% off. I says to the missus, "I bet you wished now you hadn't swapped costumes."
"Oh, I don't know," she says. "It's chilly in here."
Well, it may have been chilly then, but not after the opera got going good. Carmen was a human refrigerator compared to the leading lady in this show, set through two acts, and you couldn't hardly believe it was December. But the curtain was supposed to go up at 8:10, and it wasn't only about that time when we got there, so there was over half an hour to kill before the show began. I looked in my program and seen the real translation of the title, "The Love of Three Kings," it says, and no "of God" to it. I'd have knew anyway, when I'd read the plot, that he didn't have nothing to do with it. I listened a while to Bishop and Bess.
"And you saw all the operas?" she asked him.
"Most of them," he says.
"How grand," says Bessie. "I wish I could see a lot of them."
"Well," he says, "you're going to be here for some time."
"Oh, Mr. Bishop, I don't want you throwing all your money away on me," she says.
"I don't call it throwing money away," says Bishop. "I wouldn't either," I says. "I'd say Bishop was muscle-bound." They didn't pay no attention to me. "What ones would you like to see?" he asked her.
"What are your favorites?"
says Bess. "Oh," says Bishop, "I've saw 'em all so many times that it don't really make no difference to me. Sometimes they give two the same night, two short ones, and then you ain't so liable to be bored. Saturday nights is when they usually give the two, and Saturday nights they cut the prices. This here Bishop wasn't no boob. One good combination," he says, "is Polly Archer and Cavalier Rusticana. They're both awful pretty."
"Oh, I'd love to see them," says Bessie. "What are they like?"
So he says Polly Archer was a leading lady in a stock company, and the leading man and another fellow was both stuck on her, and she loved one of them. I forget which one. Whichever wasn't her husband. And there was a place in one of their shows where the one that was her husband was supposed to get jealous and stab her and her lover just acting. But instead of just pretending, this one night he played a joke on him and done the stabbing in earnest, and they was both killed. Well, that'd be a good one to see if you happen to be there the night he really kills them. Otherwise, it sounds pretty tame. And Bishop also told her about Cavalier Rusticana. That means rural free delivery in English. And I didn't get the plot, only that the mail carrier flirts with one of the farmer's wives, and of course the rube spears him with a pitchfork. The state's attorneys must have been on the jump all the while in them days. Finally, the orchestra was all in their places, and an old guy with a beard came out in front of them. "That's the conductor," says Bishop. "He looks like he's been a long time with the road," I says. Then up went the curtain and the thermometer. The scene's laid in Little Italy, but you can't see nothing when it starts off because it's supposed to be just before morning. Pretty soon one of the three kings comes in with a grouch. He's old and blind as a bat, and he ain't slept good, and he's sore at the conductor on account of the train being a half hour late, and the conductor's jealous of him because his beard's longer, and Archibald, that's the old king's name, won't sing what the orchestra's playing, but just snarls and growls, and the orchestra can't locate what key he's snarling in, so they don't get along at all. And finally, Flamingo, that's the old king's chauffeur, steers him off on the stage. Across on the other side of the stage from where they go off, there's a bungalow, and out of it comes Flora and another of the kings, a young fellow with a tenor voice named Vito. They sing about what a fine morning it is in Wop, and she tells him he'd better fly his kite before Archibald catches him. It seems like she's married to Archibald's son, Fred, but of course she likes Vito better or it wouldn't be no opera. Her and Vito was raised in the same ward, and they was once engaged to be married. But Archibald's gang trimmed Vito's in a big roughhouse one night, and Flora was part of the spoils. When Archibald seen how good she could fix spaghetti, he was bound she'd stick in the family, so he gave her the choice of being killed or marrying his boy. So she took Fred, but didn't really mean it in earnest. So Vito hangs around the house a lot, because old Archibald's blind, and Fred's generally always on the road with the Erie section gang. But old Archibald's eyes being no good, his ears is so much the better, even if he doesn't sometimes keep with the orchestra. So he comes back on the stage just after Vito's went, and he hears Flora trying to snoop back in her bungalow. "Who was you talking to?" he says. "Myself," says Flora. "Great stuff," says Archibald. "Up and outdoors at 5 a.m. to talk to yourself. Feed that to the goldfish." So she ain't got him fooled for a minute, but whilst they's arguing, Fred blows in. So Archibald don't say nothing about his superstition because he ain't sure. So Fred and his missus goes in the bungalow to have breakfast, and Archibald stays on the stage quarreling with the conductor. If Fred was eating all through the intermission, he must have been as hungry as me, because it was plain 40 minutes before the second act began. Him and Flora comes out of their house, and Fred says he's got to go right away again, because there's a bad washout this side of Huntington. He ain't no sooner gone than Vito's back on the job, but Flora's kind of sorry for her husband, and Vito don't get the reception that a star ought to expect. "Why don't you smile at me?" he says. So she says, "It don't seem proper, dearie, with a husband on the Erie." But before long she can't resist his high notes. And the next 5 or 10 minutes is a love scene between the two, and there was a couple of times when I thought the management would ring down the asbestos curtain. Finally, old Archibald snoops back on the stage with Flamingo, and Vito runs. But Archie hears him, and it's good night. The old boy gives Flora the third degree, and she owns up. And then Flamingo says that Fred's coming back to get his dinner pail, so Archibald insists on knowing the fella's name that he heard him running away. But Flora's either forgot it or else she's stubborn, so Archie loses his temper and wrings her neck. So when Fred arrives, he gets the surprise of his life and finds out he's a widow. "I slayed her," says Archibald. "She wasn't no good." "She was the best cook we ever had," says Fred. "What was the matter with her?" "She had a gentleman friend," says his old man. Well, so far there's only one dead and nothing original about how it was pulled. You could go over to the Victoria and see any number of throttlings at 50 cents for the best seats. So it was up to the management to get a wallop into the last act. It took 'em pretty near 40 minutes to think of it, but it was good when it come. The scene is Colosimo's undertaking rooms, and Flora's ruins is laid out on the counter. All the wops from her ward stand round singing gospel hymns. When they've beat it, Vito approaches the beer bar and wastes some pretty fair singing on the late Flora. Then all of a sudden he leans over and gives her a kiss. That's all for Vito. You see, old Fox Archibald had figured that the bird that loved her would pull something like this, and he doped out a way to learn who he was and make him regret it at the same time, besides springing some brand new stuff in the killing line. So he's mixed up some rat poison and garlic and spread it on the lips of his fair daughter-in-law. While Vito's dying, Fred comes in and finds him. "So it was you, was it?" he says. "I'm the guy," says Vito. "Well," says Fred, "this'll learn you a lesson, you old masher, you." "I'll mash you in a minute," says Vito, but the way he was now he couldn't have mashed turnips. "I kissed her last, anyway," says Vito. "You think you did," says Fred, and helps himself to the garlic. So Vito's dead, and Fred's leaning over the counter, dying, when Archibald wobbles in. He finds his way up to Fred and grabs a hold of him, thinking it's the stranger. "Lay off of me, Pa," says Fred. "This ain't the other bird. He's dead, and it's got me, too." "Well," says the old man, "that ought to satisfy them. But it's pretty tough on the Erie."
"How grand," says Bess when it was over.
"But it leaves you with a bad taste,"
says Bishop. "And a big appetite," I says.
"Did that old man kill them all?"
asked the missus. "All but himself and Flamingo," says I.
"What was he mad at?" says she.
"He was drove crazy by hunger," I says. "His wife and his sister-in-law and her fella was starving him to death."
"Being blind, he probably spilled things at table," says the missus. "Blind men sometimes has trouble getting their food."
"The trouble ain't confined to the blind," says I. When we got outside, I left Bess and Bishop lead the way, hoping they'd lead towards a steak garage. "No hurry about getting home," I hollered to them. "The night's still young yet." Bishop turned round. "Is there any good eating places out by your place?" he says. I thought I had him. "Not as good as downtown," says I, and I named the Loop restaurants. "How's the car service after midnight?" he says. "Grand," says I, "all night long." I wondered where he would take us. Him and Bess crossed the avenue and stopped where the crowd was waiting for southbound cars.
"He's got some favorite place a ways south," says the missus.
A car come, and I and her clumb aboard. We looked back just in time to see Bessie and Bishop waving us farewell.
"They missed the car," says the missus.
"Yes," I says, "and they was just as anxious to catch it as if it had been the leprosy."
"Never mind," says the missus. "If he wants to be alone with her, it's a good sign."
"I can't eat a sign," says I.
"We'll stop at the Ideal and have a little supper of our own," she says.
"We won't," says I.
"Why not?"
says the missus. "Because," I says, "they's exactly 35 cents in my pocket, and offering my stomach 17.5 cents worth of food now would be just about like sending one blank cartridge to the Russian army."
"I think there's some crackers in the house," she says.
"Probably," says I. "We're usually that way, overstocked. You don't seem to realize that our household goods is only insured for 1,000. About 1 o'clock I went to sleep from sheer weakness. About 1:30 the missus shook me and woke me up.
"We win, Joe," she says all excited. "I think Bishop and Bess is engaged."
"Win," says I. "Say, if you was a Frenchman, you'd have a big celebration every anniversary of the Battle of Waterloo."
"I was going out in the kitchen to get a drink," she says. "Bess was home, but I didn't know it. And when I was coming back from the kitchen, I happened to glance in the living room, and I see Bishop kiss her. Isn't it great?"
"Yes," says I. "But I wished she'd have had Archibald fix up her lips." End of Three Kings and a Pear. Chapter 3 of Gulliver's Travels, etc. by Ring Lardner. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Gulliver's Travels. 1. I promised the wife that if anybody asked me what kind of a time did I have at Palm Beach, I'd say I had a swell time. And if they asked me who did we meet, I'd tell them everybody that was worth meeting. And if they asked me didn't the trip cost a lot, I'd say yes, but it was worth the money. I promised her I wouldn't spill none of the real details. But if you can't break a promise you make to your own wife, what kind of a promise can you break? Answer me to that, Edgar. I'm not one of these kind of people that'd keep a joke to themselves just because the joke was on them, but there's plenty of our friends that I wouldn't have 'em hear about it for the world. I wouldn't tell you, only I know you're not the village gossip and won't crack it to anybody. Not even your own missus, see? I don't trust no women. It was along last January when I and the wife was both hit by the society bacillus. I think it was at the opera. You remember me telling you about us and the Hatches going to Carmen, and then me taking my missus and her sister Bess and four of one suit named Bishop to see the Three Kings? Well, I'll own up that I enjoyed wearing the soup and fish and mingling amongst the high polite and pretending we really was somebody. And I know my wife enjoyed it, too, though there was nothing said between us at the time. The next stage was where our friends wasn't good enough for us no more.
We used to be tickled to death to spend an evening playing rummy with the Hatches. But all of a sudden they didn't seem to be no fun in it, and when Hatch'd call up, we'd stall out of it. From the number of times I told him that I or the missus was tired out and going right to bed, he must have thought we'd got jobs as telephone line men. We quit attending picture shows because the rest of the audience wasn't the kind of people you'd care to mix with. We didn't go over to Ben's and dance because there was no class to the crowd there. About once a week, we'd beat it to one of the good hotels downtown, all dressed up like a horse, and have our dinner with the rest of the elite. There wasn't nobody talked to us, only the waiters, but we could look as much as we liked, and it was sport trying to guess the names of the gang at the next table. Then we took to reading the society news at breakfast. It used to be that I didn't waste time on nothing but the market and sporting pages, but now I pass 'em up and listen while the missus rattled off what was doing on the Lake Shore Drive. Every little while we'd see where so-and-so was at Palm Beach, or just going there, or just coming back. We got to kidding about it. Well, I'd say, we'd better be starting pretty soon or we'll miss the best part of the season. Yes, the wife would say back. We'd go right now if it wasn't for all them engagements next week. We kidded and kidded, till finally one night she forgot we was just kidding. You didn't take no vacation last summer, she says. No, says I, there wasn't no chance to get away. But you promised me, she says, that you'd take one this winter to make up for it. I know I did, I says, but it'd be a sucker play to take a vacation in weather like this. The weather ain't like this everywheres, she says. You must have been going to night school, I says. Another thing you promised me, says she, was that when you could afford it, you'd take me on a real honeymoon trip to make up for the dinky one we had. That still goes, I says, when I can afford it. You can afford it now, says she. We don't owe nothing, and we got money in the bank. Yes, I says, pretty close to $300. You forgot something, she says. You forget them war babies. Did I tell you about that? Last fall, I done a little dabbling in crucial steel, and at this time I'm telling you about, I still had hold of it, but stood to pull down 600. Not bad, eh? It'd be a mistake to let loose now, I says. All right, she says, hold on, and I hope you lose every cent. You never did care nothing for me. Then we done a little spooning, and then I asked her what was the big idea. We ain't swelled on ourselves, she says, but I know, and you know, that the friends we've been associating with ain't in our class. They don't know how to dress, and they can't talk about nothing but their goldfish and their meat bills. They don't try to get nowheres, but all they do is play rummy and take in the majestic. I and you like nice people and good music and things that's worthwhile. It's a crime for us to be wasting our time with riff and raff that'd run around barefooted if it wasn't for the police. I wouldn't say we'd wasted much time on 'em lately, I says. No, says she, and I've had a better time these last 3 weeks than I ever had in my life. And you can keep right on having it, I says. I could have a whole lot better time, and you could too, she says, if we could get acquainted with some congenial people to go around with, people its taste is the same as ourn. If any of them people calls up on the phone, I says, I'll be as pleasant to 'em as I can. You're always too smart, says the wife. You don't pay any attention to no schemes of mine. What's the scheme now? You find fault with it because I thought it up, she says. If it was your scheme, you'd think it was grand. If it really was good, you wouldn't be scared to spring it, I says. Will you promise to go through with it, says she. If it ain't too ridiculous, I told her. See, I knowed that'd be the way, she says. Don't talk crazy, I says. Where'd we be if we went through with every plan you ever sprang? Will you promise to listen to my side of it without acting cute, she says. So I didn't see no harm in going that far. I want you to take me to Palm Beach, says she. I want you to take a vacation, and that's where we'll spend it. And that ain't all we'll spend, I says. Remember your promise, says she. So I shut up and listened. The dope she gave me was along these lines. We could get special round-trip rates on any of the railroads, and that part of it wouldn't cost nowheres near as much as a man'd naturally think. The hotel rates was pretty steep, but the meals was throwed in, and just imagine what them meals would be. And we'd be staying under the same roof with the Vanderbilts and Goulds, and eating at the same table, and probably, before we was there a week, calling them Steve and Gus. They was dancing every night, and all the guests danced with each other, and how would it feel foxtrotting with the president of the B&O or the Delmonico girls from New York? And all Chicago society was down there, and when we met 'em, we'd know 'em for life and have some real friends amongst 'em when we got back home. That's how she had it figured, and she must have been practicing her speech because it certainly did sound good to me. To make it short, I fell and dated her up to meet me downtown the next day and call on the railroad bandits. The first one we seen admitted that his was the best route, and that he wouldn't only soak us $147.70 to and from Palm Beach and back, including an apartment from here to Jacksonville, and as many stopovers as we wanted to make. He told us we wouldn't have to write for no hotel accommodations, because the hotels had an agent right over on Madison Street that'd be glad to do everything to us. So we says we'd be back later, and then we beat it over to the Florida East Coast's local studio. "How much for a double room by the week?" I asked the man. "There ain't no weekly rates," he says. "By the day it'd be $12 and up for two at the Breakers, and $14 and up at Point Siena." "I like the Breakers better," says I. "You can't get in there," he says. "They're full for the season." "That's a long spree," I says.
"Can we get in at the other hotel?"
asked the wife.
"I can find out," says the man.
"We want a room with a bath," says she.
"That'd be more," says he. "That'd be $15 or $16 and up."
"What do we want of a bath?" I says, "with a whole Atlantic Ocean in the front yard."
"I'm afraid you'd have trouble getting a bath," says the man. "The hotels is both of them pretty well filled up on account of the war in Europe."
"What's that got to do with it?" I asked him. "A whole lot," he says. "The people that usually goes abroad is all down to Palm Beach this winter." "I don't see why," I says. "If one of them U-boats hit 'em, they'd at least be getting their bath for nothing." We left him with the understanding that he was to wire down there and find out what was the best they could give us. We called him up in a couple of days, and he told us we could have a double room, without no bath, at the Point Siena, beginning the 15th of February. He didn't know just what the price would be. Well, I fixed it up to take my vacation starting the 10th, and sold out my Crucial Steel, and divided the spoils with the railroad company. We decided we'd stop off in St. Augustine 2 days, because the missus found out somewheres that there might be 2 or 3 of the 400 lingering there, and we didn't want to miss nobody. "Now," I says, "all we got to do is set round and wait for the 10th of the month."
"Is that so?" says the wife. "I suppose you're perfectly satisfied with your clothes."
"I've got to be," I says, "unless the Salvation Army has something that'll fit me."
"What's the matter with our charge account?" she says.
"I don't like to charge nothing," I says, "when I know they ain't no chance of ever paying for it."
"All right," she says, "then we're not going to Palm Beach. I'd rather stay home than go down there looking like general housework."
"Do you need clothes yourself?" I asked her.
"I certainly do," she says, "about $200 worth. But I got $150 of my own."
"All right," I says, "I'll stand for the other 50, and then we're all set."
"No, we're not," she says. "That just fixes me. But I want you to look as good as I do."
"Nature'll see to that," I says. But there was no arguing with her. Our trip, she says, was an investment. It was going to get us in right with people worthwhile. And she wouldn't have a chance in the world unless we looked the part. So before the 10th came round, we was long 2 new evening gowns, 2 female sport suits, 4 or 5 pairs of shoes, all colors, 1 tuxedo dinner coat, 3 dress shirts, 6 other kinds of shirts, 2 pairs of transparent white trousers, 1 new business suit, and Lord knows how much underwear and how many hats and stockings. And I had till the 15th of March to pay off the mortgage on the old homestead. Just as we was getting ready to leave for the train, the phone rung. It was Mrs. Hatch, and she wanted us to come over for a little rummy. I was shaving, and the missus done the talking.
"What did you tell her?" I asked.
"I told her we was going away," says the wife. "I bet you forgot to mention where we was going," I says.
"Pay me,"
says she. 2. I thought we was in Venice when we woke up next morning, but the porter says it was just Cairo, Illinois. The river'd went crazy, and I bet there wasn't a room without a bath in that old burg. As we sat down on the dinner for breakfast, the train was going across the longest bridge I ever seen, and it looked like we were so near the water that you could reach right out and grab a handful. The wife was a little wabbly.
"I wonder if it's really safe," she says.
"If the bridge stays up, we're all right," says I.
"But the question is, will it stay up?" she says.
"I wouldn't bet a nickel either way on a bridge," I says. "They's treacherous little devils. They'd cross you as soon as they'd cross this river."
"The train men must be nervous," she says. "Just see how we're dragging along."
"They're giving the fish a chance to get off the track," I says. "It's against the law to spear fish with a cow catcher this time of year." Well, the wife was so nervous she couldn't eat nothing but toast and coffee, so I figured I was justified in going to the prunes and steak and eggs. After breakfast, we went out in what they call the sun parlor. It was a glassed-in room on the tail end of the rear coach, and it must have been a pleasant place to sit and watch the scenery. But there was a gang of missionaries or something had all the seats, and they never budged out of them all day. Every time they'd come to a crossroads, they'd toss a stack of Bible studies out of the back window for the southern heathen to pick up and read. I suppose they thought they was doing a lot of good for their fellow men, but their fellow passengers, meanwhile, was getting the worst of it. Speaking of the scenery, it certainly was something grand. First, we'd pass a few pine trees with fuzz on them, and then a couple of acres of yellow mud. Then there'd be more pine trees and more fuzz, and then more yellow mud. And after a while, we'd come to some pine trees with fuzz on them, and then if we watched close, we'd see some yellow mud. Every few minutes, the train would stop and then start up again on low. That meant the engineer suspected he was coming to a station and was scared that if he run too fast, he wouldn't see it, and if he run past it without stopping, the inhabitants would never forgive him. You see, there's a regular schedule of duties that's followed out by the more prominent citizens down these parts. After their wives attended to the chores and got the breakfast, they roll out of bed and put on their overalls and eat. Then they get on their horse or mule or cow or dog and ride down to the station and wait for the next train. When it comes, they have a contest to see which can count the passengers first. The losers has to promise to work one day the following month. If one fellow loses three times in the same month, he generally always kills himself. All the towns has got five or six private residences and seven or eight two-apartment buildings and a grocery and a post office. They told me that somebody in one of them burgs, I forget which one, got a letter the day before we came through. It was misdirected, I guess. The two-apartment buildings is constructed on the ground floor, with a porch to divide one flat from the other. One's the housekeeping side, and the other's just a place for the husband and father to lay around in so's they won't be disturbed by watching the women work. It was a blessing to them boys when the States went dry. Just think what a strain it must have been to keep lifting glasses and hunting in their overalls for a dime. In the afternoon, the missus went into our apartment and took a nap, and I moseyed into the reading room and looked over some of the comical magazines. There was a fat guy coming and sat next to me. I'd heard him at lunch telling the dining car conductor what Wilson should have done, so I wasn't surprised when he opened up on me. "Tiresome trip," he says. I didn't think it was worthwhile arguing with him. "Must have been a lot of rain through here," he says. "Either that," says I, "or else the sprinkling wagon runs shy of streets." He laughed as much as it was worth. "Where do you come from?" he asked me. "Dear old Chicago," I says. "I'm from St. Louis," he says. "You're Frank," says I. "I'm really as much at home one place as another," he says. "The wife likes to travel, and why shouldn't I humor her?" "I don't know," I says. "I haven't the pleasure." "Seems like we're going all the while," he says. "It's Hot Springs, or New Orleans, or Florida, or Atlantic City, or California, or somewheres." "You get passes?" I asked him. "I guess I could if I wanted to," he says. "Some of my best friends is way up in the railroad business." "I got one like that," I says. "He generally stands on the fourth or fifth car behind the engine." "Do you travel much?" he asked me. "I don't live in St. Louis," says I. "Is this your first trip south?" he asked. "Oh, no," I says. "I live on 65th Street.
Ahmed, have you ever been down this way before?
Oh, yes, says I. I come down every winter.
Where do you go? He asked.
That's what I was laying for.
Palm Beach, says I.
I used to go there, he says, but I've cut it out. It ain't like it used to be. They leave everybody in now.
Yes, I says, but a man don't have to mix with them.
You can't just ignore people that comes up and talks to you, he says.
Are you bothered that way much? I asked.
It's what drove me away from Palm Beach, he says.
How long since you've been there? I asked him.
How long you been going there? He says.
Me? Says I.
5 years.
We just missed each other, says he. I quit 6 years ago this winter.
Then it couldn't have been there I seen you, says I, but I know I seen you somewheres before.
It might have been most anywheres, he says. There's few places I haven't been at.
Maybe it was across the pond, says I.
Very likely, he says, but not since the war started. I've been steering clear of Europe for 2 years.
So have I, for longer than that, I says.
It's certainly an awful thing, this war, says he.
I believe you're right, says I, but I haven't heard nobody express it just that way before.
I only hope, he says, that we succeed in keeping out of it.
If we got in, would you go? I asked him.
Yes, sir, he says.
You wouldn't beat me, says I. I bet I'd reach Brazil as quick as you.
Oh, I don't think there'd be any action in South America, he says. We'd fight defensive at first, and most of it would be along the Atlantic coast.
Then maybe we could get accommodations in Yellowstone Park, says I.
There's no sense in this country getting involved, he says. Wilson hasn't handled it right. He either ought to have went stronger or not so strong. He's wrote too many notes.
You certainly get right to the root of a thing, says I. You must have thought a good deal about it.
I know the conditions pretty well, he says. I know how far you can go with them people over there. I've been amongst them a good part of the time.
I suppose, says I, that a fellow just naturally don't like to butt in. But if I was you, I'd consider it my duty to romp down to Washington and give him all the information I had.
Wilson picked his own advisers, said he. Let him learn his lesson.
That ain't hardly fair, I says. Maybe you was out of town, or your phone was busy or something.
I don't know Wilson, nor he don't know me, he says.
That oughtn't to stop you from helping him out, says I. If you seen a man drowning, would you wait for some friend of the both of you to come along and make the introduction?
There ain't no comparison in them two cases, he says. Wilson ain't never called on me for help.
You don't know if he has or not, I says. You don't stick in one place long enough for a man to reach you.
My office in St. Louis always knows where I'm at, says he. My stenographer can reach me any time within 10 to 12 hours.
I don't think it's right to have this country's whole future dependent on a St. Louis stenographer, I says.
That's nonsense, says he. I ain't making no claim that I could save or not save this country. But if I and Wilson was acquainted, I might tell him some facts that'd help him out in his foreign policy.
Well, then, I says, it's up to you to get acquainted.
I'd introduce you myself, only I don't know your name.
My name's Gould, says he, but you're not acquainted with Wilson.
I could be easy, says I. I could get on a train he was going somewheres on, and then go and sit beside him and begin to talk.
Lots of people make friends that way.
It was getting along towards supper time, so I excused myself and went back to the apartment. The missus had woke up and wasn't feeling good.
"What's the matter?" I asked her.
"This old train," she says. "I'll die if it don't stop going round them curves."
"As long as the track curves, the best thing the train can do is curve with it," I says. "You may die if it keeps curving, but you'd die a whole lot sooner if it left the rails and went straight ahead."
"What you been doing?" she asked me.
"Just talking to one of the ghouls," says I. "Gould," she says. "What Gould?"
"Well," I says, "I didn't ask him his first name, but he's from St. Louis, so I suppose it's Ludwig or Heine."
"Oh," she says, disgusted, "I thought you meant one of the real ones."
"He's a real one, all right," says I. "He's so classy that he's passed up Palm Beach. He says it's getting too common."
"I don't believe it," says the wife. "And besides, we don't have to mix up with everybody."
"He says they butt right in on you," I told her.
"They'll get a cold reception from me," she says.
But between the curves and the fear of Palm Beach not being so exclusive as it used to be, she couldn't eat no supper, and I had another big meal. The next morning we landed in Jacksonville 3 hours behind time and narrowly missed Canexus for St. Augustine by over an hour and a half. There wasn't another train till 1:30 in the afternoon, so we had some time to kill. I went shopping and bought a shave and 5 or 6 Rickies. The wife helped herself to a chair in the writing room of one of the hotels and told pretty near everybody in Chicago that she wished they was along with us, accompanied by a picture of the Elks home or the Germania Club or trout fishing at Atlantic Beach. While I was getting my dime's worth in the tonsorial parlors, I happened to look up at a calendar on the wall and noticed it was the 12th of February. "How does it come that everything's open here today?" I says to the barber. "Don't you all know it's Lincoln's birthday?" "Is that so?" he says. "How old is he?" 3. We'd wired ahead for rooms at the Alcazar, and when we landed in St. Augustine, there was a motor bus from the hotel to meet us at the station. "Southern hospitality," I says to the wife, and we was both pleased till they relieved us of 4 bits apiece for the ride. Well, they hadn't neither one of us slept good the night before, while we was jolting through Georgia, so when I suggested a nap, there was no argument.
"But our clothes ought to be pressed," says the missus. "Call up the valet and have it done while we sleep."
So I called up the valet, and sure enough, he came. "Hello, George," I says. "You see, we're going to lay down and take a nap, and we was wondering if you could crease up these 2 suits and have them back here by the time we want them."
"Certainly, sir," says he.
"And how much will it cost?" I asked him.
$1 a suit," he says.
"Are you on parole, or haven't you ever been caught?" says I.
"Yes, sir," he says, and smiled like it was a joke. "Let's talk business, George," I says. "The tailor we go to on 63rd walks 2 blocks to get our clothes, and 2 blocks to take 'em to his joint, and 2 blocks to bring 'em back, and he only soaks us 35 cents a suit."
"He gets poor pay, and he does poor work," says the burglar. "When I press clothes, I press 'em right."
"Well," I says, "the tailor on 63rd satisfies us. Suppose you don't do your best this time, but just give us 70 cents worth."
But there was no chance for a bargain. He'd been in the business so long he'd become hardened and lost all regard for his fellow men. The missus slept, but I didn't. Instead, I'd done a few problems in arithmetic. Aside of what she gave up for postcards and stamps in Jacksonville, I'd spent $2 for our lunch, about 2 more for my shave and my refreshments, 1 for a rough ride and a bus, 1 more for getting our trunk and grips carried round, 2 for having the clothes pressed, and about $0.50 in tips to people I would never see again. Somewhere near $9 a day, not counting no hotel bill, and over 2 weeks of it yet to come. Oh, you rummy game at home, at 0.5 cent a point. When our clothes came back, I woke her up and gave her the figures.
"But today's an exception," she says. "After this, our meals will be included in the hotel bill, and we won't need to get our suits pressed only once a week, and you'll be shaving yourself, and there won't be no bus fare when we're staying in one place. Besides, we can practice economy all spring and all summer."
"I guess we need the practice," I says.
"And if you're going to crab all the time about expenses," says she, "I wish we had have stayed home."
"That'll make it unanimous," says I.
Then she began sobbing about how I'd spoiled the trip, and I had to promise I wouldn't think no more of what we were spending. I might as well have promised to not worry when the White Sox lost or when I'd forgot to come home to supper.
We went in the dining room about 6:30 and was showed to a table where there was another couple setting. They was husband and wife, I guess, but I don't know which was which. She was wielding the pencil and writing down their order.
"I guess I'll have clams," he says. "They disagreed with you last night," says she.
"All right," he says, "I won't try 'em. Give me cream of tomato soup."
"You don't like tomatoes," she says.
"Well, I won't have no soup," says he. "A little of the bluefish." "The bluefish was no good at noon," she says. "You better try the bass."
"All right, make it bass," he says, "and them sweetbreads and a little roast beef and sweet potatoes and peas and vanilla ice cream and coffee."
"'You wouldn't touch sweetbreads at home,' says she, "'and you can't tell what they'd be in a hotel.' "'All right, cut out the sweetbreads,' he says. "'I should think you'd have the stewed chicken,' she says, "'and leave out the roast beef.' "'Stewed chicken it is,' says he. "'Stewed chicken and mashed potatoes and string beans "'and buttered toast and coffee. "'Will that suit you?' "'Sure,' he says, and she gave the slip to the waiter. "'George looked at it long enough to have read it 3 times, "'if he could have read it once, "'and then went out in the kitchen "'and got a trayful of whatever was handy.' But the poor guy didn't get more than a taste of anything. She was watching him like a hawk, and no sooner would he delve into one victual than she'd yank the dish away from him and tell him to remember that health was more important than temporary happiness. I felt so sorry for him that I couldn't enjoy my own repast, and I told the wife that we'd have our breakfast apart from that stricken soul if I had to carry the case to old Al Cesar himself. In the evening we strolled across the street to the Ponce. That's supposed to be even swoller yet than where we were stopping at. We walked all over the place without recognizing anybody from our set. I finally warned the missus that if we didn't duck back to our room, I'd probably have a heart attack from excitement. But she'd read in her Florida guide that the decorations and pictures were worth going miles to see, so we had to stand in front of them for a couple of hours and try to keep awake. 4 or 5 of them was thrillers at that. Their names was Adventure, Discovery, Contest, and so on. But what they all should have been was called the lady who had mislaid her clothes. The hotel's named after the fellow that built it. He come from Spain, and they say he was hunting for some water that if he'd drunk it, he'd feel young. I don't see myself how you could expect to feel young on water, but anyway, he'd heard that this here kind of water could be found in St. Augustine. And when he couldn't find it, he went into the hotel business and got even with the United States by charging $5 a day and up for a room. Sunday morning we went in to breakfast early, and I asked the head waiter if we could set at another table where there was no convalescent and his mate. At the same time I gave the said head waiter something that spoke louder than words. We were showed to a place way across the room from where we'd been the night before. It was a table for 6, but the other 4 didn't come into our life until that night at supper. Meanwhile we went sightseeing. We visited Fort Marion. That'd be a great protection against the Germans. Provided they fought with paper wads. We seen the city gate and the cathedral and the slave market, and then we took the boat over to Anastasia Island, that the ocean's on the other side of it. This trip made me homesick, because the people that was along with us on the boat looked just like the ones we'd often went with to Michigan City on the 4th of July. The boat landed on the bay side of the island, and from there we was drug over to the ocean side on a horse car. The horse walking to one side of the car instead of in front, so's he wouldn't get ran over. We stuck on the beach till dinner time, and then took the chariot back to the pavilion on the bayside, where a whole family served the meal and their pigs put on a cabaret. It was the best meal I'd had in dear old Dixie, fresh oysters and chicken, and mashed potatoes and gravy, and fish and pie, and they charges 2 bits a plate. "'Goodness gracious,' says the missus when I told her the price. "'This is certainly reasonable. I wonder how it happens.' "'Well,' I says, "'the family was probably washed up here by the tide "'and don't know they're in Florida.' "'When we got back to the hotel, "'there was only just time to clean up and go down to supper. "'We had no sooner got seated when our table companions breezed in. "'It was a man about 45 that looked like he'd made his money in express "'and general hauling.' And he had his wife along, and both their mother-in-laws. The shirt he had on was the one he'd started from home with, if he lived in Yokohama. His women folks wore mourning, with a touch of gravy here and there. "'You order for us, Jake,' says one of the ladies. So Jake grabbed the bill of fare, and his wife took the slip and pencil and waited for the dictation. "'Let's see,' he says. "'How about oyster cocktail?'
"'Yes,' says the 3 Mrs. Black.
4 oyster cocktails, then, says Jake, and 4 orders of blue points.
The oysters is nice, too, says I. They all gave me a cordial smile, and the ice was broke.
Everything's good here, says Jake. I bet you know, I says. He seemed pleased at the compliment and went on dictating. 4 chicken soups with rice, he says, and 4 of the bluefish, and 4 veal chops breaded, and 4 roast chicken, and 4 boiled potatoes, but it seemed his wife would rather have sweet potatoes.
"'All right,' says Jake, 4 boiled potatoes and 4 sweets.
and chicken salad and some of that tapioca pudding and ice cream and tea. Is that satisfactory?
Fine, says one of the mother-in-laws.
Are you going to stay long?
Says Mrs. Jake to my missus. The party dress didn't look very clubby, but she was too polite to pull the cut direct.
We leave tomorrow night, she says.
Nobody asked her where we was going.
We leave for Palm Beach, she says. That's a nice place, I guess, says one of the old ones. More people goes there than comes here. It ain't so expensive there, I guess.
You're some guesser, says the missus, and freezes up. I asked Jake if he'd been to Florida before.
No, he says, this is our first trip, but we're making up for lost time. We're seeing all there is to see and having everything the best.
You're having everything all right, I says, but I don't know if it's the best or not. How long have you been here?
A week tomorrow, says he, and we stay another week and then go to Ormond.
Are you standing the trip okay? I asked him.
Well, he says, I don't feel quite as good as when we first come.
Kind of loggy, I says.
Yes, kind of heavy, says Jake.
I know what you ought to do, says I.
You ought to go to a European plan hotel.
Not while the war's on, he says. And besides, my mother's a poor sailor.
Yes, says his mother, I'm a very poor sailor.
Jake's mother can't stand the water, says Mrs. Jake. So I began to believe that Jake's wife's mother-in-law was a total failure as a jolly tar. Social intercourse was put an end to when the waiter staggered in with their order and iron. The missus seemed to have lost her appetite and just sat there looking grouchy and tapping her fingers on the tablecloth and acting like she was in a hurry to get away. I didn't eat much neither. It was more fun watching. Well, I says when we was out in the lobby, we finally got acquainted with some real people.
Real people, says the missus, curling her lip. What did you talk to them for?
I couldn't resist, I says. Anybody that had ordered 4 oyster cocktails and 4 rounds of blue points is worth knowing.
Well, she says, if they're there when we go in tomorrow morning, we'll get our table changed again, or you can eat with them alone.
But they was absent from the breakfast board.
They're probably staying in bed today to get their clothes washed, says the missus.
Or maybe they're sick, I says. A change of oysters affects some people. I was for going over to the island again and getting another of them quarter banquets, but the program was for us to walk around town all morning and take a ride in the afternoon. First we went to St. George Street and visited the oldest house in the United States. Then we went to Hospital Street and seen the oldest house in the United States. Then we turned the corner and went down St. Francis Street and inspected the oldest house in the United States. Then we dropped into a soda fountain, and I had an egg phosphate made from the oldest egg in the Western Hemisphere. We passed up lunch and got into a carriage drawn by the oldest horse in Florida, and we rode through the country all afternoon, and the driver told us some of the oldest jokes in the book. He felt it was only fair to give his customers a good time when he was charging $1 an hour, and he had his gags rehearsed so he could tell the same one 1,000 times and never change a word. And the horse knowed where the point come in every one and stopped to laugh. We done our packing before supper, and by the time we got to our table, Jake and the mourners was through and gone. We didn't have to ask the waiter if they'd been there. He was perspiring like an evangelist. After supper, we said goodbye to the night clerk and $22. Then we bought ourselves another ride in the motor bus and landed at the station 10 minutes before train time, so we only had an hour to wait for the train. Say, I don't know how many stations they is between New York and San Francisco, but they's twice as many between St. Augustine and Palm Beach. And our train stopped twice and started twice at every one. I gave up trying to sleep and looked out the window, amusing myself by reading the names of the different stops. The only one that expressed my sentiments was, oh, golly. We was an hour and a half late pulling out of that joint, and I figured we'd be 2 hours to the bed getting into our destination. But the guy that made out the timetable must have had the engineer down pat, because when we went across the bridge over Lake Worth and landed at the Poinciana Depot, we was 10 minutes ahead of time. There was about 2 dozen uniformed EIFs on the job to meet us. and when I seen 'em all grab for our baggage with one hand and hold the other out, face up, I knowed why they call it Palm Beach. 4. The Poinciana station's a couple of hundred yards from one end of the hotel, and that means it's close to 5 miles from the clerk's desk. By the time we'd registered and been gave our key and marathoned another 5 miles or so to where our room was located at, I was about ready for the inquest. But the missus was full of pep and wild to get down to breakfast and look over our stablemates. She says we would eat without changing our clothes. People would forgive us for not dressing up on account of just getting there. While she was looking out the window at the royal palms and buzzards, I moseyed about the room, inspecting where the different doors led to. Pretty near the first one I opened went into a private bath. "There," I says, "they've gave us the wrong room." Then my wife seen it and began to squeal.
"Goody," she says, "we've got a bath, we've got a bath."
"But," says I, "they promised we wouldn't have none. It must be a mistake."
"Never you mind about a mistake," she says. "This is our room, and they can't chase us out of it."
"We'll chase ourselves out," I says. "Rooms with a bath is $15 and $16 and up. Rooms without no bath is bad enough."
"We'll keep this room, or I won't stay here," she says.
"All right, you win," I says, but I didn't mean it. I made her set in the lobby downstairs while I went to the clerk, pretending that I had to see about our trunk. "Say," I says to him, "you've made a bad mistake. You told your man in Chicago that we couldn't have no room with a bath, and now you've give us one." "You're lucky," he says. "A party who had a bath ordered for those 2 weeks canceled their reservation, and now you've got it." "Lucky, am I?" I says. "And how much is the luck going to cost me?" "It'll be $17 per day for that room," he says, and turned away to hide a blush. I went back to the wife. "Do you know how much we're paying for that room?" I says. "We're paying $17.
"Well," she says, "our meals is throwed in."
"Yes," says I, "and the hotel furnishes a key."
"You promised in St. Augustine," she says, "that you wouldn't worry no more about expenses."
Well, rather than make a scene in front of the bellhops and the few millionaires that was able to be about at that hour of the morning, I just says, "All right," and led her to the dining room. The head waiter met us at the door and turned us over to his assistant. Then some assistants took hold of us one at a time, and we was relayed to a beautiful spot next to the door of the kitchen and bounded on all sides by posts and pillars. It was all right for me, but a whole lot too private for the missus, so I had to call the fellow that had been our pacemaker on the last lap. "We don't like this table," I says. "It's the only one I can give you," he says. I slipped him half a buck.
"Come to think of it," he says, "I believe there's one I forgot all about."
So he moved us way up near the middle of the place.
"Say, you ought to have seen that dining room. From one end of it to the other is a toll call. And if a man that was settin' at the table farthest from the kitchen ordered roast lamb, he'd get mutton." At that, they was crowded for fare, and it kept the head waiters hustlin' to find enough space for one and all. It was round 9 o'clock when we put in our modest order for orange juice, oatmeal, liver and bacon, and cakes and coffee, and 9:45 or so when our waiter returned from the nearest orange grove with Exhibit A. We amused ourselves meanwhile by giving our neighbors the once-over and wondering which of them was going to pal with us. As far as I could tell from the glances we received, there wasn't no immediate danger of us being annoyed by attentions. There was only a few women folks on deck, and they was dressed pretty quiet, so quiet that the missus was scared she'd shock 'em with the sport skirt she'd bought in Chi. Later on in the day, when the girls come out for their dress parade, the missus' costume made about as much noise as eating marshmallows in a foundry. After breakfast, we went to the room for a change of raiment. I put on my white trousers and wished to heaven that the sun would go under a cloud till I got used to telling people without words just where my linen began and I left off. The rest of my outfit was white shoes that hurt and white socks and a $2 silk shirt that showed up a zebra, and a red tie, and a soft collar, and a blue coat. The missus wore a sport suit that I won't try and describe. You'll probably see it on her sometime in the next 5 years. We went downstairs again and out on the porch where some of the old birds was taking a sunbath. "Where now?" I says. "The beach, of course," says the missus.
Where is it at? I asked her.
I suppose, she says, that we'll find it somewheres near the ocean.
I don't believe you can stand this climate, says I.
The ocean, she says, must be down at the end of that avenue where most everybody seems to be headed.
Having went back to our room and back twice, I don't feel like another 5 mile hike, I says.
It ain't no 5 miles, she says, but let's ride anyway.
Come on, says I, pointing to a streetcar that was standing in the middle of the avenue.
Oh, no, she says. I've watched and found out that the real people takes them funny-looking wheelchairs.
I was wondering what she meant when one of them pretty near run over us. It was part bicycle, part go-kart, and part African. In the one we dodged, there was room for one passenger, but some of them carried two. I wonder what they'd soak us for the trip, I says.
Not more than a dime, I wouldn't believe, says the missus.
But when we'd hired one and been whisked down under the palms and past the golf field to the bathhouse, we was obliged to part with 50 cents legal and tender. I feel much refreshed, I says. I believe when it comes time to go back, I'll be able to walk. The bathhouse is across the street from the other hotel, the Breakers, that the man had told us was full for the season. Both buildings fronts on the ocean, and boy, it's some ocean. I bet there's fish in there that's never seen each other.
Oh, let's go bathing right away, says the missus.
Our suits is up to the other beanery, says I, and was glad of it. There wasn't nothing tempting to me about them man-eating waves. But the wife's a persistent cuss.
We won't go today, she says, but we'll go in the bathhouse and get some rooms for tomorrow.
The bathhouse porch was a ringer for the Follies. Here and down on the beach was where you see the costumes at this time of day. I was so busy rubbering that I passed the entrance door 3 times without noticing it. From the top of their heads to the bottom of their feet, the girls was a mess of colors. There wasn't no two dressed alike, and if any one of them had to walk down State Street, we'd have had an epidemic of stiff necks to contend with and shy. Finally, the missus grabbed me and hauled me into the office.
2 private rooms, she says to the clerk, 1 lady and 1 gent.
$5 a week apiece, he says. But we're all filled up. You ought to be all locked up, I says.
Will you have anything open tomorrow? Asks the missus.
I think I can fix you then, he says. What do we get for the 5? I asked him. Private room, and we take care of your bathing suit, says he. How much if you don't take care of the suit? I asked him. My suit's been getting along fine with very little care. $5 a week apiece, he says, and if you want the rooms, you'd better take them because they're in big demand. By the time we'd closed this grand bargain, everybody'd moved off on the porch and down to the water, where a couple dozen of them went in for a swim, and the rest sat and watched. There was a long row of chairs on the beach for spectators, and we was just going to flop into 2 of them when another bandit come up and told us it cost a dime apiece per hour. We're going to be here 2 weeks, I says. Will you sell us 2 chairs? He wasn't in no comical mood, so we sunk down on the sand and seen the show from there. We had plenty of company that preferred these kinds of seats free to the chairs at 10 cents a whack. Besides the people that was in the water getting knocked down by the waves and pretending like they enjoyed it, about half of the gang on the sand was wearing bathing suits just to be clubby. You could tell by looking at the suits that they had never been wet and wasn't intended for no such ridiculous purpose. I wished I could describe them to you, but it'd take a female to do it right. One little girl, either 14 or 24, had white silk slippers and socks that come pretty near up to her ankles, and from there to her knees it was just plain nature. Northbound from her knees was a pair of bicycle trousers that disappeared when they came to the bottom of her Mother Hubbard. This here garment was a thing without no necks or sleeves that began bulging at the top and spread out gradual all the way down like a croquet. The topper off, she had a jockey cap, and believe me, I'd have played her mount across the board. There was plenty of class in the field with her, but nothing that approached her speed. Later on, I seen her several times around the hotel, wearing something near the same outfit, without the jockey cap, and with longer croquets. We sat there in the sand till people begun to get up and leave. Then we trailed along back of them to the Breakers' porch, where there was music to dance and stuff to inhale. "'Well, grab a table,' I says to the missus. "'I'm dying of thirst.' But I was allowed to keep on dying. "'I can serve you something soft,' says the waiter. "'I bet you can't,' I says. "You ain't got no locker here?" he says. "What do you mean, locker?" I asked him. "It's the locker liquor law," he says. "We can serve you a drink if you own your own bottles." "I'd just as soon own a bottle," I says. "I'll become the proprietor of a bottle of beer." "It'll take 3 or 4 hours to get it for you," he says, "and you'll have to order it through the order desk. If you're stopping at one of the hotels and want a drink once in a while, you better get busy and put in an order." So I had to watch the missus put away a glass of orange juice that cost 40 cents, and that was just the same size as they gave us for breakfast free for nothing. And not having had nothing to make me forget that my feet hurt, I was obliged to pay another 4 bits for an Afromobile to cart us back to our own boarding house. "Well," says the missus when we got there, "it's time to wash up and go to lunch."
"Wash up and go to lunch, then," I says, "but I'm going to investigate this here locker liquor or liquor locker law."
So she got her key and beat it, and I limped to the bar. "I want a highball," I says to the boy.
"What's your number?" says he. "It varies," I says. "Sometimes I can hold 20, and sometimes 4 or 5 makes me sing."
"I mean, have you got a locker here?" he says.
"No, but I want to get one," says I.
"The gent over there to the desk will fix you," says he. So over to the desk I went and asked for a locker.
"What do you drink?" asked the gent. "I'm from Chicago," I says. "I drink bourbon."
"What's your name and room number?" he says, and I told him. Then he asked me how often did I shave, and what did I think of the Kaiser, and what my name was before I got married, and if I had any intentions of ever running an elevator. Finally, he says I was all right. "I'll order you some bourbon," he says. "Anything else?" I was going to say no, but I happened to remember that the wife generally always wants a Bronix before dinner. So I had to also put in a bid for a bottle of gin and bottles of the Vermouth brothers, Tony and Pierre. It wasn't till later that I appreciated what a grand law this here law was. When I got my drinks, I paid 10 cents apiece for 'em for service, besides paying for the bottles of stuff to drink. And besides that, about every third highball or Bronix I ordered, the waiter'd bring back word that I was just out of ingredients, and then there'd be another delay while they sent to the garage for more. If they had that law all over the country, there'd soon be an end of drinking, because everybody gets so mad they'd kill each other. My cross-examination had took quite a long time, but when I got back to my room, the wife wasn't back from lunch yet, and I had to cover the marathon route all over again and look her up. We only had the one key to the room, and of course couldn't expect no more than that at the price. The missus had brought one of the daily programs they get out, and she knowed just what we had to do the rest of the day. "For the next couple of hours," she says, "we can suit ourselves."
"All right," says I. "It suits me to take off my shoes and lay down."
"I'll rest too," she says, "but at 4:30 we have to be in the Coconut Grove for tea and dancing, and then we come back to the room and dress for dinner. Then we eat, and then we set around till the evening dance starts. Then we dance till we're ready for bed."
"Who do we dance all these dances with?" I asked her.
"Well, whoever we get acquainted with," she says.
"All right," says I, "but let's be careful."
Well, we took our nap, and we followed schedule and had our tea in the Coconut Grove. You know how I love tea. My feet was still aching, and the missus couldn't talk me into no dance. When we'd sat there an hour and was saturated with tea, the wife says it was time to go up and change into our tuxedos. I was all in when we reached the room and willing to even pass up supper and nestle in the hay, but I was informed that the biggest part of the day's doings was yet to come. So from 6 o'clock till after 7 I wrestled with studs and hooks and eyes that didn't act like they'd ever met before and wasn't anxious to get acquainted, and then down we went again to the dining room.
"How about a little Bronix before the feed?" I says.
"It would taste good," says the missus.
So I called Eef and gave him the order. In something less than a 30 minutes he came back empty-handed. "You ain't got no cocktail stuff," he says. "I certainly have," says I. "Ordered it early this afternoon."
"Where at?" he asked me.
"Over in the bar," I says.
"Oh, the regular bar," he says. "That don't count. You got to have stuff at the service bar to get it served in here."
"I ain't as thirsty as I thought I was," says I.
"Me neither," says the missus.
So we went ahead and ordered our meal, and while we was waiting for it, a young couple come and took the other 2 chairs at our table. They didn't have to announce through a megaphone that they was honeymooners. It was wrote all over 'em.
They was reaching under the table for each other's hands every other minute, and when they wasn't doing that, they was smiling at each other or giggling at nothing. You couldn't feel that good and be paying $17 a day for room and board unless you was just married or something. I thought at first our company would be fun, but after a few meals it got like the southern cooking and began to undermine the health. The conversation between they and us was what you could call limited. It took place the next day at lunch. The young husband thought he was about to take a bite of the entry, which happened to be roast mutton with syrup, but he couldn't help from looking at her at the same time, and his empty fork started for his face, prongs up. "Look out for your eye," I says. He dropped the fork, and they both blushed till you could see it right through the sunburn. Then they gave me a Mexican look, and our acquaintance was at an end. This first night, when we was through eating, we wandered out in the lobby and took seats where we could watch the passing show. The men was all dressed like me, except I was up to date and had on a mushroom shirt, while they was sporting the old-fashioned concrete bosom. The women's dresses begun at the top with a belt, and some of them stopped at the mezzanine floor, while others went clear down to the basement and helped keep the rugs clean. There was one who must have thought it was the 4th of July. From the top of her head to where the top of her bathing suit had left off, she was a red, red rose. From there to the top of her gown was white, and her gown, what there was of it, was blue.
"My," says the missus, "what stunning gowns."
"Yes," says I, "and you could have one just like 'em if you'd take the shade off from the piano lamp at home and cut it down to the right size." Round 10 o'clock we wandered in the palm garden, where the dancing had been renewed. The wife wanted to plunge right in the mazes of the foxy trot. "It'll take some courage first," says I. And then was when I found out that it cost you 10 cents extra besides the tip to pay for a drink that you already owned in fee simple. Well, I guess we must have danced about 6 dances together and had that many quarrels before she was ready to go to bed. And oh, how grand that old hay pile felt when I finally bounced into it. The next day we went to the ocean at the legal hour, 11:30. I never had so much fun in my life. The surf was running high, I heard him say, and I don't know which I'd rather do, go bathing in the ocean at Palm Beach when the surf is running high, or have a dentist get one of my molars ready for a big inlay at a big outlay. Once in a while I managed to not get throat on my head when a wave hit me. As for swimming, you had as much chance as if you was at State and Madison at the noon hour. And before I'd been in a minute, there was enough salt in my different features to keep the Blackstone Hotel running all through the onion season. The missus enjoyed it as much as me. She tried to pretend at first, and when she got floored, she'd give a squeal that was supposed to mean heavenly bliss. But after she'd been bruised from head to feet, and her hair looked and felt like spinach with French dressing, and she drank all she could hold of the Gulf Stream, she didn't resist none when I drug her in the shore and staggered with her up to our private rooms at 5 a week per each. Without consulting her, I went to the desk at the casino and told them they could have them rooms back. "All right," says the clerk, and turned our keys over to the next in line. "How about a refund?" I asked him, but he was waiting on somebody else. After that, we done our bathing in the tub. But we was down to the beach every morning at 11:30 to watch the rest of 'em get batted around. And at 12:30 every day, we'd follow the crowd to the breaker's porch and dance together, the missus and I. Then I'd be back to the other hostelry, sometimes limping and sometimes in an Afromobile, and a drink or two in the Palm Garden before lunch. And after lunch we'd lay down, or we'd pay some $2 or $3 to peddle us through the winding jungle trail that was every bit as wild as the Art Institute. Or we'd ferry across Lake Worth to West Palm Beach and take in a movie. Or we'd stand in front of the portable 5th Avenue stores while the missus wished she could have this dress or that hat or something else she couldn't have looked at if she'd been at home and in her right mind. But always at 4:30 we had to live up to the rules and be in the Coconut Grove for tea and some more foxy trotting. And then it was dress for dinner, eat dinner, watch the parade, and wind up the glorious day with more dancing. I'll bet you any amount you name that the Castles in their whole life haven't danced together as much as I and the missus did at Palm Beach. I'd have gave $5 if even one of the waiters had took her off in my hands for one dance. but I knowed that if I made the offer public, there'd been a really serious quarrel between us instead of just the minor brawls occasioned by stepping on each other's feet. She made a discovery one night. She found out there was a place called the Beach Club, where most of the real people disappeared to every evening after dinner. She says we would have to go there, too. "But I ain't a member," I says.
"Then find out how you get to be one," she says.
So to the Beach Club I went and made inquiries. "You'll have to be introduced by a guy that already belongs," says the man at the door. "Who belongs?" I asked him. "Hundreds of people," he says. "Who do you know?" 2 waiters, 2 barkeepers, and 1 elevator boy," I says. He laughed, but his laugh didn't get me no membership card, and I had to dance 3 or 4 extra times the next day to square myself with the missus. She made another discovery, and it cost me $6. She found out that though the meals in the regular dining room was included in the trifling rates per day, the real people had at least 2 of their meals in the garden grill and paid extra for 'em. We tried it for 1 meal, and I must say I enjoyed it, all but the check. "We can't keep up that clip," I says to her.
"We could," says she, "if you wasn't spending so much on your locker."
"The locker's a matter of life and death," I says. "There ain't no man in the world that could dance as much with their own wife as I do and live without liquid stimulus." When we'd been there 4 days, she got to be on speaking terms with a lady's maid that hung around the lobby and helped put the costumes back on when they slipped off. From this here maid, the missus learned who was who, and the information was relayed to me as soon as there was a chance. We'd be setting on the porch when I'd feel an elbow in my ribs all of a sudden. I'd look up at who was passing, and then try and pretend I was excited.
"Who is it?"
I'd whisper. "That's Mrs. Vandevetter," the wife'd say. "Her husband's the biggest streetcar conductor in Philadelphia." Or somebody had sat beside us at the beach or at the palm garden, and my ribs would get all battered up before the missus was calm enough to tip me off.
"The Vincents," she'd say, "the canned pruned people."
It was a little bit thrilling at first to be rubbing elbows with all them celebs, but it got so finally that I could walk out of the dining room right behind Scotty the opera singer without forgetting that my feet hurt. The Washington's birthday ball brought 'em all together at once, and the missus pointed out 8 and 9 at a time and got me so mixed up that I didn't know Pat Vanderbilt from Maggie Rockefeller. The only one you couldn't make no mistake about was a Russian count you couldn't pronounce. He was buying bay mules or something for the Russian government, and he was in ambush.
"They say he can't hardly speak a word of English," says the missus.
"If I knowed the word for barber shop in Russia," says I, "I'd tell him there was one in this hotel." 5. In our mailbox the next morning, there was a notice that our first week was up, and all we owed was $146.50. The bill for room and meals was $119. The rest was for getting clothes pressed and keeping the locker damp. I didn't have no appetite for breakfast. I told the wife I'd wait up in the room and for her to come when she got through. When she blew in, I had my speech prepared. "Look here," I says. "This is our 8th day in Palm Beach society. You're on speaking terms with a maid, and I've got acquainted with 6 of the male hired help. It's cost us about $165, including them private rooms down to the casino and our Afromobile trips, and this and that. You know a whole lot of swell people by sight, but you can't talk to 'em. It'd be just as much satisfaction and hundreds of dollars cheaper to look up their names in the telephone directory at home, then phone to 'em, and when you got 'em, tell 'em it was the wrong number. That way you'd get 'em to speak to you, at least. As for sport," I says, "we don't play golf, and we don't play tennis, and we don't swim. We go through the same program of doing nothing every day. We dance, but we don't never change partners. For $12, I could buy a phonograph up home, and I and you could trot around the living room all evening without no danger of having some of them fancy birds cave our shins in. And we could have twice as much liquid refreshments up there at about 1/20 the cost. That ghoul I met on the train coming down," I says, "was an even bigger liar than I give him credit for. He says that when he was here, people pestered him to death by coming up and speaking to him. We ain't had to dodge nobody or hide behind a coconut tree to remain exclusive. He says Palm Beach was too common for him. What he should have said was that it was too lonesome. If there was just one white man here that had listened to my stuff, I wouldn't have no kick. But it ain't no pleasure telling stories to the Eves. They laugh whether it's good or not, and then want a dime for laughing. As for our clothes, I says, they would be all right for a couple of days' stay. But the dames round here, and the men, too, have something different to put on every morning, afternoon, and night. You've wore your two evening gowns so much that I just have to snap my finger at the hooks, and they go and grab the right eyes. The meals would be grand, I says, if the cook didn't keep getting mixed up and putting pudding sauce on the meat and gravy on the pie. I'm glad we've been to Palm Beach, I says. I wouldn't have missed it for nothing. But the ocean won't be no different tomorrow than it was yesterday, and the same for the daily program. It don't even rain here to give us a little variety. Now what do you say, I says, to us just settling the bill, and whatever we owe since then, and beating it out of here just as fast as we can go? The missus didn't say nothing for a while. She was too busy crying. She knowed that what I said was the truth, but she wouldn't give up without a struggle.
"Just 3 more days," she says finally. "If we don't meet somebody worth meeting in the next 3 days, I'll go wherever you want to take me."
"All right," I says. "3 more days it is. What's a little matter of $60? Well, in them next 2 days and a half, she done some desperate flirting. But as it was all with women, I didn't get jealous. She picked out some of the elite of Chicago and tried every trick she could think of. She told them their noses was shiny and offered them her powder. She stepped on their white shoes just so to get a chance to beg their pardon. She told them their clothes was unhooked and then unhooked them so she could hook them up again. She tried to loan them her fingernail tools. When she seen one fanning herself, she'd say,
"Excuse me, Mrs. So-and-so, but we got the coolest room in the hotel, and I'd be glad to have you go up there and quit perspiring."
But not a rise did she get. Not till the afternoons of the 3rd day of grace. And I don't know if I ought to tell you this or not, only I'm sure you won't spill it nowheres. We'd went up in our room after lunch. I was tired out, and she was discouraged. We'd sat round for over an hour, not saying or doing nothing. I wanted to talk about the chance of us getting away the next morning, but I didn't dast bring up the subject. The missus complained of it being hot and opened the door to leave the breeze go through. She was sitting in a chair near the doorway, pretending to read the Palm Beach News. All of a sudden she jumped up and kind of hissed at me. "What's the matter?" I says, springing from the lounge.
"Come here,"
she says, and went out the door into the hall. I got there as fast as I could, thinking it was a rat or a fire, but the missus just pointed to a lady walking away from us 6 or 7 doors down.
"It's Mrs. Potter," she says, "the Mrs. Potter from Chicago."
"Oh," I says, putting all the excitement I could into my voice. And I was just starting back into the room when I seen Mrs. Potter stop and turn around and come toward us. She stopped again about 20 feet from where the missus was standing.
"Are you on this floor?"
she says. The missus shook like a leaf.
"Yes,"
says she, so low you couldn't hardly hear her.
"Please see there's some towels put in 559,
says the Mrs. Potter from Chicago. 6. About 5 o'clock the wife quieted down, and I thought it was safe to talk to her. "I've been reading in the guide about a pretty river trip," I says. "We can start from here on the boat tomorrow morning. They run to Fort Pierce tomorrow and stay there tomorrow night. The next day they go from Fort Pierce to Rockledge, and the day after that from Rockledge to Daytona. The fare is only $5 apiece, and we can catch a northbound train at Daytona."
"All right, I don't care,"
says the missus. So I left her and went downstairs and across the street to ask Mr. Foster. Ask Mr. Foster happened to be a girl. She sold me the boat tickets and promised she would reserve a room with bath for us at Fort Pierce, where we was to spend the following night. I bet she knowed all the while that rooms with a bath in Fort Pierce is scarcer than toes on a sturgeon. I went back to the room and helped with the packing in an advisory capacity. Neither one of us had the heart to dress for dinner. We ordered something sent up and got soaked an extra dollar for service. But we was past caring for a little thing like that. At 9 o'clock the next morning, the good ship Constitution stopped at the Point Siena dock while we piled aboard. One bellhop was down to see us off, and it cost me a quarter to get that much attention. Mrs. Potter must have overslept herself. The boat was loaded to the guards, and I ain't bragging when I say that we was the best-looking people aboard. And as for manners, why, say, old Bill Sykes could have passed off for Henry Chesterfield and that gang. Each one of them occupied three of the deck chairs and sprayed orange juice all over their neighbors. We could have talked to plenty of people here, all right. They were as clubby a gang as I ever seen. But I was afraid that if I said something, they'd have to answer, and with their mouths as full of citrus fruit as they were, the results might have been fatal to my light suit. We went up the lake to a canal, and then through it to Indian River. The boat ran aground every few minutes and had to be pried loose. About 12 o'clock, a colored gentleman came up on deck and told us lunch was ready. At 1:30, he served it at a long family table in the cabin. As far as I was concerned, he might as well have left it on the stove. Even if he could have bit into the food, a glimpse of your fellow diners would have strangled your appetite. After the repast, I called the missus aside. "Something tells me we're not going to live through 3 days of this," I says. "What about taking the train from Fort Pierce and beating it for Jacksonville and then home?"
"But that'd get us to Chicago too quick," says she. "We told people how long we was going to be gone, and if we got back ahead of time, they would think there was something queer."
"There's too much queer on this boat," I says. "But you're going to have your own way from now on." We landed in Fort Pierce about 6. It was only 2 or 3 blocks to the hotel, but when they laid out that part of town, they overlooked some of the modern conveniences, including sidewalks. We staggered through the sand with our grips, and sure had worked up a hunger by the time we reached Ye Inn. "Got reservations for us here?" I asked the clerk. "Yes," he says, and led us to him in person. The room he showed us didn't have no bath, or even a chair that you could sit on while you pulled off your socks. "Where's the bath?" I asked him. "This way," he says, and I followed him down the hall, outdoors, and up an alley. Finally, we come to a bathroom complete in all details, except it didn't have no door. I went back to the room, got the missus, and went down to supper. Well, sir, I wish you could have been present at that supper. The choice of meats was calves, liver, and onions, or calves, liver, and onions. And I bet if them calves that had still been living yet, they could have gave us some personal reminiscences about Garfield. The missus gave the banquet one look and then laughed for the first time in several days. "The guy that named this burg got the capitals mixed," I says. "It should have been Port Fierce." And she laughed still heartier. Taking advantage, I says, "How about the train from here to Jacksonville?"
"You win," says she.
"We can't get home too soon to suit me."
7. The morning we landed in Chicago, it was about 8 above, and a wind was coming off in the lake a mile a minute. But it didn't faze us.
"Lord," says the missus, "ain't it grand to be home?"
"You said something," says I, "but wouldn't it have been grander if we hadn't never left?"
"I don't know about that," she says. "I think we both of us learned a lesson."
"Yes," I says. "And the tuition wasn't only a matter of close to $700.
"Oh," says she, "we'll get that back easy."
"How?" I asked her. "Do you expect some tips on the market from Mrs. Potter and the rest of your new friends?"
"No," she says. "We'll win it. We'll win it in the rummy game with the hatches."
End of Gullible's Travels. Chapter 4 of Gullible's Travels, etc. by Ring Lardner. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. The Water Cure.
When it comes to making matches, I hand it to the women. When it comes to breaking them, leave it to the handsomer sex. The 13th of June didn't light on a Friday, but old Tuesday came through in a pinch with just as good results. Dear little sister-in-law Bess blew in on the afternoon train from Wabash. She says she was making us a surprise visit. The surprise affected me a good deal like the one that was pulled on Napoleon at Waterloo, Iowa. "How long are you going to light up our home?" I asked her at the supper table.
"I haven't made up my mind," says she.
"That's all you've missed, then," I says.
"Don't mind him," says my missus. "He's just a tease. You look grand, and we're both tickled to death to have you here. You may stay with us all summer."
"No question about that," I says. "Not only may, but liable to."
"If I do," says Bess, "it'll be in my sister's account, not yourn."
"But I'm the baby that settles your sister's account," I says, "and it was some account after you left us last winter. With your visit and our cute little trip to Palm Beach, I'm not what you call cramped for pocket space."
"I guess I can pay my board," says Bess.
"I guess you won't," says the wife. "The second guess is always better," says I.
"As for you entertaining me, I don't expect nothing like that,"
says Bess. "If you was looking for a quiet time," I says, "you made a big mistake by leaving Wabash."
"And I'm not looking for no quiet time, neither," Bess says right back at me.
"Well," says I, "about the cheapest noisy time I can recommend is to go over and set under the elevated." "Maybe Bess has something up in her sleeve," the missus says, smiling. "You ain't the only man in Chicago." "I'm the only one she knows," says I, "outside of that millionaire scenario writer that had us all in misery last winter. And I wouldn't say he was over-ardent after he'd knew her a week." Then the wife winked at me to close up, and I didn't get the dope until we was alone together.
"They correspond," she told me.
"Absolutely," says I.
"I mean, they've been writing letters to each other," says the missus.
"Who's been buying Bishop's stamps?" I asked her.
"I guess a man can buy his own stamps when he gets $10,000 a year," says she. "Anyway, the reason Bess is here is to see him."
"Is it illegal for him to go to Wabash and see her?" I says.
"He's too busy to go to Wabash," the wife says.
"I don't see how a man could be too busy for that," says I.
"She phoned him this noon," says the missus. "He couldn't come over here tonight, but tomorrow he's going to take her to the ball game."
"Where all the rest of the busy guys hangs out," I says. "Aren't the White Sox having enough bad luck without him?" That reminded me that I'd come home before the final extras was out, so I put on my hat and went over to Tim's to look at the scoreboard. It took me until 1 a.m. to memorize the batteries and everything. The wife was still awake yet when I got home, and I had enough courage to resume hostilities. "If what you told me about Bishop and Bess is true," I says, "I guess I'll pack up and go fishing for the rest of the summer."
"And leave me to starve, I suppose," says she.
"Bishop will take care of the both of you," I says. "If he don't, I'll send you home a couple of carp."
"If you go and leave me, it's the last time," she says, "and it shows you don't care nothing about me."
"I care about you all right," I says, "but not enough to be drove crazy in my own house."
"There's nothing for you to go crazy about," she says. "If Bess and Mr. Bishop wants to tie up, leave 'em alone and forget about 'em."
"I'd like nothing better," I says. "But you know they'll give us no chance to forget about 'em."
"Why not?" she asked me.
"Because they'd starve to death without us," I says.
"Starve to death," she says, "on $10,000 a year?"
"Now here," I says, "who told you he got that trifle?"
"He did," says the wife.
"And how do you know he wasn't overestimating?" I asked her.
"You mean, how do I know he wasn't lying?" she says.
"Yes," says I.
"Because he's a gentleman," she says.
"And he told you that, too," I asked.
"No, I could tell that by looking at him."
"All right, clairvoyant," I says, "and maybe you can tell by looking at me how much money he borrowed off'n me and never gave back."
"When? How much?"
she says.
"One at a time," says I. "The amount of the cash transaction was a $20 gold certificate, and the dime he shook me down was the evening he took us to hear Ida and was supposed to be paying for it."
"I can't believe it," says the missus.
"All right," I says. "When he brings Bessie home from the ball game tomorrow, I'll put it to him right in front of you."
"No, you mustn't do that," she says. "I won't have him insulted."
"You would have him insulted if I knew how to go about it," I says.
"You stayed over at Tim's too long," says the wife.
"Yes," says I, "and I made arrangements to stay over there every time Bishop comes here."
"Suit yourself," she says, and pretended like she was asleep.
Well, the next morning I got to thinking over what I'd said and wondering if I'd went too strong, but I couldn't see where. This Bird was a dude that had got acquainted with Bessie on the train when she was on her way here to visit us last winter. He'd infested the house all the while she was with us. He'd give us that $10,000 yarn and told us he made it by writing moving picture plays. But we never seen none of 'em advertised and never run into anybody that ever heard of him. The missus had picked him out for Bess the minute she seen him. Bessie herself had fell for him strong. To keep 'em both from dropping cyanide in my gruel, I'd took him along with us to see The Love of Three Kings, besides buying his groceries and provisions for pretty near a week and standing for the upkeep on the Davenport where him and Bess held hands. Finally, after he'd went 6 days without submitting even circumstantial evidence that he'd ever had a dime, I bullied him into saying he'd give us a party. Then there'd been an argument over where he'd take us. He suggested a vaudeville show, but I jumped on that with both feet. Bessie held out for a play, but I told her there wasn't none that I'd leave a young unmarried sister-in-law of mine go to.
"Oh," Bess had said, "they must be some that's perfectly genteel."
"Yes," I told her, "there is some, but they're not worth seeing." So they'd asked what was left, and I'd mentioned Grand Opera.
"They're worse than plays, the most of 'em," was the wife's cut in.
"But all the risky parts is sang in Latin and Greek," I'd said. Well, Bishop put up a great fight, but I wouldn't break ground, and finally he says he would take us to opera if he could get tickets. "I'm downtown every day," I told him. "I'll have 'em reserved for you." But no, he wouldn't see me put to all that trouble for the world. He'd do the buying himself. So Ida was what he took us to on a Sunday night when the seats was cut to half price. And when I and him went out between acts to try the limes, he catched me with my guard down and frisked the 20. Now, Bess had tipped off the wife that her and Bishop was practically engaged, but the night after Ida was the last night of her visit, and Bishop hadn't never come round. So Bessie cried all night and tried to get him by phone before she left next day, but neither of them two acts done her any good. It looked like he was all through. On the way to the train, Bess and the missus had ruined 3 or 4 handkerchiefs and called the Bird every low-down flirt they could think of. I didn't say a word, nor did I perfume my linen with brine. Here, though, was Bess back in town and old man Short making up to her again, and they'd been corresponding. The second time was liable to take, unless outside brains came to the rescue. If I thought for a minute that they'd leave us out of it and go away somewhere by themselves and live, the North Side or one of the suburbs, or Wabash, I wouldn't have cared how many times they married each other. But I had him spotted for a loafer that couldn't earn a living, and I knowed what the maritime nuptials between Bess and he meant. It meant that I and the missus would have all the pleasures of conducting a family hotel without the pain of making out receipts. Now, I always wanted a boy and a girl, but I wanted them to be kind of youngish when I got 'em. I never craved adding a married couple to my family, not even if they was crazy about rummy and paid all their bills. And when it come to Bishop and Bess, well, they was just as welcome to my home as Villa and the Little Villains. It wasn't just Bishop with his quaint habit of never having car fare. Bess, in her way, was just as much of a liability. You couldn't look at her without a slight relapse. She had 2 complexions, A.M. and P.M. The P.M. wasn't so bad, but she could have put the other in her vanity box for a mirror. Her nose curved a little away from the batsman and wasn't no wider than a julienne potato,
and yet it had to draw in to get between her eyes. Her teeth was real pretty, and she always kept her lips ajar. But the baseball reporters named Maddie's favorite delivery after her chin, and from there down, the curves was taboo. Where she made a hit with Bishop was laughing at everything he pulled. That is, he thought she was laughing. The fact was that she was snatching the chance to show more of them teeth. There was no use showing them to me, so I didn't get laughs from her on my stuff, only when he or some other stranger was round. And if my stuff wasn't funnier than Bishop's, I'll lay down my life for Austria. As a general rule, I don't think a man is justified at interfering with other people's hymeneal intentions. But it's different when the said intentions is going to make your own home a hell. It was up to me to institute proceedings that would check the flight of these two cooing doves before their wings took them to Crown Point in a yellow flivver. And I seen my duty all the more clear when the pair came home from the ball game the day after Bessie's arrival and not only told me that the White Sox got another trimming, but laughed when they said it. "Well, Bishop," I says when we sat down to supper, "how many six-reelers are you turning out a day?" "About one every 2 weeks is the limit," says Bishop. "I'll bet it is," I says, "and who are you working for now?" "The Western Film Corporation," he says, "but I'm going to quit them the first of the month." "What for?" I asked him. "Better offer from the Criterion," he says. "Better than $10,000 a year," says I. "Sure," he says. $20 better?" I says. He blushed, and the wife sunk my shin with a patent leather torpedo. Then Bishop says, "The raise I'm getting would make $20 look sick." "If you'd give it to me," I says, "I'd try and nurse it back to health." After supper, the missus called me out in the kitchen to bawl me out.
"It's rough stuff to embarrass a guest," she says.
"He's always embarrassed," says I. "But you admit now, don't you, that I was telling the truth about him touching me?"
"Yes," she says.
"Well," says I, "if he's so soiled with money, why don't he pay a little puny debt?"
"He's probably forgot it," says she.
"Did he look like he'd forgot it?" I asked her, and she had no comeback. But when my missus can overlook a guy stinging me for legal tender, it means he's in pretty strong with her. And I couldn't count on no help from her, even if Bishop was a murderer, so long as Bess wanted him. The next morning, just to amuse myself, I called up the Criterion people and asked them if they was going to hire a scenario writer named Elmer Bishop. "Never heard of him," was what they told me. So I called up the Western. "Elmer Bishop?" they says. "He ain't no scenario writer. He's what we call an extra. He plays small parts sometimes." "And what pay do them extras drag down?" I asked. $5 a day. But nothing when they don't work," was the thrilling response. My first idea was to slip this dope to the wife and Bess both. But what'd be the use? They wouldn't believe it even if they called up and found out for themselves. And if they did believe it, Bessie'd say a man's pay didn't make no difference where true love was concerned, and the missus would take her part, and they'd cry a little and wind up by sending for Bishop and a minister to make sure of the ceremony coming off before Bishop lost his $5 job and croaked himself. Then I thought of forbidding him the hospitality of my abode. But that'd be just as useless. They'd meet somewheres else. And if I threatened to lock Bess out, the wife would come back with a counter-proposition to not give me no more stewed beets or banana souffles. Besides that, strong-arm methods don't never kill sweet love, but act just the opposite and make the infected parties more set on getting each other. This here case was something delicate, and if a man didn't handle it exactly right, you wouldn't never get over being sorry. So instead of me quarreling with the wife and Bess and raising a fuss at Bishop spending 8 evenings a week with us, I kept my clam closed and tried to be pleasant, even when I'd win a hand of rummy and see this guy carelessly lose a few of his remaining face cards under the table. We had an awful spell of heat in July, and it wasn't no fun playing cards and going to picture shows or nothing. Saturday afternoons and Sundays, I and the missus would go over to the lake and splash. Bess only went with us a couple of times, but that was because she couldn't get Bishop to come along. He'd always say he was busy, or had a cold and was afraid of making it worse. So far as I was concerned, I managed to enjoy my bath just as much with them two staying away. The sight of Bessie in a bathing suit crabbed the exhilarating effects of the swim. When she stood up in the water, the minnows must have thought two people was still fishing. It was one night at supper, after Bessie'd been with us about a month, when the idea came to me. Bishop was there, and I'd been looking at he and Bess, and wondering what they'd seen in each other. The missus asked him if they was going out someplace.
"No," says Bessie, "it's too hot, and they ain't no place to go."
"There's lots of places to go," says the wife. "For one thing, they're having grand opera out to Ravinia Park."
"I wouldn't give a nickel to see a grand opera," says Bess, "unless it was Ida that Elmer took us to last winter."
So they went on talking about something else. I don't know what, because the minute she mentioned Ida, I was all set. I guess maybe I better tell you a little about this here opera so's you'll see how it helped me out. A fellow named Gust Verity wrote it, and the scenes is laid along the Illinois Central round Memphis and Cairo. Ida's a big wench with a pretty voice, and she's the hired girl in the mayor's family. The mayor's daughter gets stuck on a fat little tenor that you can't pronounce and that should have had a lawnmower ran over his chin. The tenor likes the colored girl better than the mayor's daughter, and the mayor's daughter tries every way she can think of to bust it up and grab off the tenor for herself, but nothing doing. Finally, the mayor has the tenor pinched for keeping open after 1 o'clock, and the law is pretty strict. So instead of just fining him, they lock him up in a safety deposit vault. Well, the wench is down in the vault, too, dusting off the papers and cleaning the silver, and they don't know she's there. So the two of them's locked up together and can't get out. And when they can't get away and haven't got nobody else to look at or talk to, they get so's they hate each other. And finally, they can't stand it no longer, and they both die. There's pretty music in it, but if old Gus had seen the men that was going to be in the show, he'd have laid the scenes in Beardstown instead of Memphis. Well, do you get the idea? If the mayor's daughter had been smart, instead of trying to keep the tenor and Ida from being with each other, she'd have locked them up together a long while ago, and first thing you know, they'd have been sick of one another, and just before they died, she could have let them out and had the tenor for herself without no argument. And the same thing would work with Bishop and Bess. In all the time of their mutual courtship, they hadn't been together for more than 5 or 6 hours at a time, and never where one of them couldn't make a quick duck when they got tired. Make them stick around with each other for a day or for 2 days without no chance to separate, and it was a cinch that the alarm clock would break in on love's young dream. But for some reason or other, I didn't have no safety deposit vault, and there wasn't no room in the flat they couldn't get out of by jumping from the window. How was I going to work it? I thought, and figured and figured, and it wasn't until after I went to bed that the solution came. A boat trip to St. Joe. I and the missus and the two lovebirds. And I'd see to it that the chaperones kept their distance and let nature take its course. We'd go over some Saturday afternoon and come back the next night. That'd give them 8 or 9 hours Saturday and from 12 to 16 hours Sunday to get really acquainted with each other. And if they were still on speaking terms at the end of that time, I'd pass up the case as incurable. You see, I had it doped that Bishop was afraid of water, or else he wouldn't have turned down all our swimming parties. I wouldn't leave him a chance to duck out of this because I wouldn't tell nobody where we was going. It'd be a surprise trip. And there was a good chance that they'd both be sick if it was the least bit rough, and that'd help a lot. I thought of Milwaukee first, but I picked St. Joe because it's dry. A man might stand for Bess a whole day and more if he was a little blear-eyed from Milwaukee's favorite food. The trip would cost me some money, but it was an investment with a good chance of big returns. I'd have been willing to take him to Palm Beach for a month if that had been the only way to save my home. When Bishop blew in the next evening, I pulled it on him. "Bishop," I says, "a man that does as much brain work as you ought to get more recreation." "I guess I do work too hard," he says modestly. "I should think," I says, "that you'd give yourself Saturday afternoons and Sundays off." "I do, in summer," he says. "That's good," I says. "I was thinking about giving a little party this coming weekend, and of course I wanted you to be in on it." The two girls got all excited.
"Party?" says the missus. "What kind of a party?"
"Well," I says, "I was thinking about taking you and Bishop and Bess out of town for a little trip."
"Where to?" asked the wife.
"That's a secret," I says. "You won't know where we're going till we start. All I'll tell you is that we'll be gone from Saturday afternoon till Monday morning."
"Oh, how grand," says Bessie. "And think how romantic it'll be, not knowing where we're headed."
"I don't know if I can get away or not," says Bishop. "I pay all expenses," says I.
"Oh, Elma, you've just got to go," says Bess.
"The trip's off if you don't," I says.
"If you don't say yes, I'll never speak to you again," says Bessie.
For a minute I hoped he wouldn't say yes, but he did. Then I told him that the start would be from our house at 12:45 Saturday, and to pack up their sporty clothes. The rest of the evening was spent in them trying to guess where we was going. It got 'em nothing, because I wouldn't say aye, yes, or no to none of their guesses. When I and the missus was alone, she says,
"Well, what's the idea?"
"No idea at all," I says, "except that our honeymoon trip to Palm Beach was a flivver, and I feel as if I ought to make up to you for it. And besides that, Bessie's our guest, and I ought to do something nice for she and her friend."
"I'd think you must have been drinking, if I didn't know better," she says.
"You never do give me credit for nothing," says I. "To tell the truth, I'm kind of ashamed of myself for the way I've been acting toward Bishop and Bess. But I'm willing to make amends before it's too late. If Bishop's going to be one of the family, I and him ought to be good friends."
"That's the way I like to hear you talk," says the wife.
"But remember," I says, "this trip ain't only for their benefit, but for ourn too. And from the minute we start till we get home, us two'll pal around together just like we was alone. We don't want them buttin' in on us, and we don't want to be buttin' in on them."
"That suits me fine," says she, "and now maybe you'll tell me where we're going."
"You promise not to tell?" I asked her.
"Sure," she says.
"Well," I says, "that's one promise you'll keep." And I buried my good ear in the feathers. At 2:40 Saturday afternoon, I landed my entire party at the dock, foot of Wabash Avenue.
"Goody," says Bess, "we're going across the lake."
"If the boat stays up." "I don't know if I ought to go or not," says Bishop. "I'd ought to be where I can keep in touch with the Criterion people." "They got a wireless aboard," I says.
"Yes," says Bishop, "but they wouldn't know where to reach me."
"You got time to phone 'em before we sail," says I.
"No, he hasn't," says Bessie. "He ain't going to take no chance of missing this boat. He can send 'em a wireless after we start."
So that settled Bishop, and he had to walk up the gangplank with the rest of us. He looked just as pleased as if they'd lost his laundry. I checked the baggage and sent the three of 'em up on deck, saying I'd join 'em later. Then I asked the boy where the bar was. "Right in there," he says, pointing, "but you can't get nothing till we're 3 miles out." So I went back to the gangplank and started off the boat. A man about 4 years old with an adding machine in his hand stopped me. "Are you going to make the trip?" he asked me. "What do you think I'm on here for, to borrow a match?" says I.
"Well," he says, "you can't get off."
"You're cross," I says. "I bet your milk don't agree with you." I started past him again, but he got in front of me.
"You can get off, of course," he says, "but you can't get back on. That's the rules."
"What sense is they in that?" I asked him.
"If I let people off and on again, my account would get mixed up," he says.
"Who are you?" says I.
"I'm the government checker," he says.
"Chess?" says I, "and you count all the people that gets on?" "That's me," he says. "How many is on now?" I asked him.
800 odd, he says.
"I asked you for the number, not the description," I says. "How many's the limit?"
1,300, he says.
"And would the boat sink if there was more'n that?" says I.
"I don't know if it would or wouldn't," he says, "but that's all the law allows."
For a minute I felt like offering him a lump sum to let 700 or 800 more on the boat and be sure that she went down. Meanwhile I'd be over getting a drink. But then I happened to think that the missus would be among those lost, and though a man might do a whole lot better the second time, the chances are that he'd do a whole lot worse. So I passed up the idea and stayed aboard, praying for the time when we'd be 3 miles out on Lake Michigan. It was the shortest 3 miles you ever seen. We hadn't got out past the municipal pier when I see a steady influx going past the engine room and into the great beyond. I followed him and got what I was after. Then I went up on deck looking for my guests. I found him standing in front of one of the lifeboats. "Why don't you get comfortable?" I says to Bishop. "Why don't you get chairs and enjoy the breeze?"
"That's what I've been telling him," says the missus, "but Mr. Bishop acts like he was married to this spot."
"I'm only thinking of your wife and Bessie," says Bishop. "If anything happened, I'd want him to be near a lifeboat."
"Nothing's going to happen," I says. "They ain't been a wreck on this lake for over a month. And this here boat, the city of Benton Harbor, ain't never sank in her life."
"No," says Bishop, "and the Shakora in Eastland never sank until they sunk."
"The boats that sinks," I says, "is the boats that's overloaded. I was talking to the government checker player downstairs, and he tells me that you put 1,300 on this boat and she's perfectly safe, and there's only 800 aboard now."
"Then why do they have the lifeboats?" asked Bishop.
"So's you can go back if you get tired of the trip," I says.
"I ought to be back now," says Bishop, "where the firm can reach me."
"We ain't more than 2 miles out," I says. "If your firm's any good, they'll drag the bottom further out than this. Besides," I says, "if trouble comes, the lifeboats would handle us."
"Yes," says Bishop, "but it's women and children first."
"Sure," says I, "that's the proper order for drowning. The world couldn't struggle along without us $10,000 scenario riders."
"They couldn't be no trouble on such a lovely day as this," says Bess.
"That's where you make a big mistake," I says. "That shows you don't know nothing about the history of Lake Michigan."
"What do you mean?" asked Bishop.
"All the wrecks that's took place on this lake," I says, "has happened in calm weather like today. It's just 3 years ago this July," I says, "when the city of Ypsilanti left Grand Haven with about as many passengers as we got today. The lake was just like a billiard table and no thought of danger. Well, it seems like there's a submerged water oak about 3 miles from shore that you're supposed to steer round it. But this pilot hadn't never made the trip before, and besides that, he'd been drinking pretty heavy. So what does he do but run plump into the tree, and the boat turned a turtle, and all the passengers was lost except a tailor named Swanson."
"But that was just an unreliable officer," says Bessie. "He must have been crazy."
"Crazy," says I. "They wouldn't nobody work on these boats unless they was crazy. It's bound to get 'em."
"I hope we got a reliable pilot today," says Bishop.
"He's only just a kid," I says, "and I noticed him staggering when he came aboard. But anyway, you couldn't ask for a better bottom than they is right along in here. Nice, clean sand and hardly any weeds."
"What time do we get to St. Joe?" asked Bishop.
"About 7, if we don't run into a squall," I says. Then I and the wife left him and went around to another part of the deck and ran into squalls of all nationalities. Their mothers had made a big mistake in bringing them, because you could tell from their faces and hands that they didn't have no use for water.
"They just all look alike," says the missus. "I don't see how the different mothers can tell which is their baby."
"It's 50-50, I says. "The babies don't look no more alike than the mothers. The mothers is all named Jenny, and all perfect cubes and fond of apples, and ought to go to a dentist. Besides," I says, "suppose they did get mixed up and swap kids, none of the parties concerned would have reasons to gloat, and the babies certainly couldn't look no more miserable under different auspices than they do now."
We walked all around the deck, threading our way among the banana peelings and looking our shipmates over.
"Pick out somebody you think you'd like to meet," I told the wife, "and I'll see if I can arrange it."
"Thanks," she says, "but I'll try and not get lonesome with my husband and my sister's beau along."
"It's nice for you to say it," says I, "but you want to remember that we're leaving Bess and Bishop to themselves, and that leaves you and I to ourselves, and they ain't no two people in the world that can spend 2 days alone together without getting bored stiff. Besides, you don't want to never overlook a chance to meet high-class people."
"When I get desperately anxious to meet high-class people," she says, "I'll be sure and pick out the Saturday afternoon boat from Chicago to St. Joe."
"You can't judge people by their looks," says I. "You haven't heard 'em talk."
"No, and couldn't understand 'em if I did," she says.
"I'll bet some of 'em's just as bright as we are," I says.
"I'm not looking for bright companionship," she says. "I want a change."
"That's just like I told you," says I. "You're bound to get tired of one person, no matter how much they sparkle, if you live with them long enough."
We left the deck and went downstairs.
There was two or three people peering in the engine room, and the missus made me stop there a minute. "What for?" I asked her.
"I want to see how it works," she says.
"Well," says I, "when we'd started on again, I can drop my insurance now."
"Why?" says the missus.
"I don't never need to worry about you starving," I says. "With the knowledge you just picked up there, I bet you could easily land a job as engineer on one of these boats."
"I'd do about as good as you would at it," she says.
"Sure," I says, "because I didn't study it." "What makes the boat run?" I asked her.
"Why, the wheel," she says.
"And who runs the wheel?" I asked her.
"The pilot," says she.
"And what does the engineer do?" I says.
"Why, I suppose he keeps the fire burning," she says.
"But in weather like this, what do they want of a fire?"
"Oh, I suppose it gets colder out in the middle of the lake," she says.
"No," says I, "but on Saturdays they got to keep a fire going to heat the baby's bottles." We went in the room next to the bar. A boy sat at the piano playing Sweet Cider Time in Moonshine Valley and some Hawaiian native melodies composed by a Hungarian waiter that was too proud to fight. Three or four couple was dancing, but none of them was wry-necked enough to get the proper pose. The girls looked pretty good and was probably members of the 400 employed at the fair. The boys would have been handsomer if the laundry hadn't failed to bring back their other shirt in time. A big guy in a uniform came by and went into the next room.
"Is that the captain?" asked the wife.
"No," says I, "that's the steward."
"And what does he do?" she asked me.
"He hangs around the bar," I says, "and looks after the stews."
"Have they really got a bar?" she says.
"I'll find out for sure if you'll wait here a minute," says I, and led her to a chair where she could watch him wrestle. In the other room I stood next to a Greek that charged 10 cents on Sundays and holidays. He was all lit up like the municipal pier. "Enjoying the trip?" I asked him. too rough," he says, only I don't do the dialect very good. "I bet you never got that shine at your own stand," says I.
"Too hot to work," says he. "I don't have to work. I got them on."
"Yes," I says, "and the bun." A little way off from us was four other political enemies of old Frank Hanley, telling my Greek friend in tonsorial tones that if he didn't like his Uncle Sammy, he knew what he could do. "Don't you like your Uncle Sammy?" I asked him.
"I don't have to work," he says. "I got them on."
"Then why don't you take them boys' advice," I says, "and go back to your home over the sea?"
Too rough," he says.
And in the 20 minutes I stood there with him, finding out whether they really was a bar, he didn't say nothing except he had them on, and he didn't have to work, and something was too rough. I and the missus went back up on deck. I steered for the end of the boat that was farthest from where we'd left Bess and Bishop, but they'd begun to get restless, and we ran into them taking a walk.
"Where have you been?" asked Bessie. "Down watching them dance," says the missus.
"Is there a place to dance aboard?" asked Bishop. But I didn't want them to dance, because that'd be an excuse not to say nothing to each other for a while, so I says, "There's a place all right, but five or six couples already on the floor, and when you get more than that trotting around at once, it's liable to rock the boat and be disastrous." I took the wife's arm and started to move on. "Where are you going?" says Bishop. "Just for a stroll around the decks," says I. "We'll go along," he says. I seen the treatment was beginning to work. "Nothing doing," I says. "This is one of our semi-annual honeymoons, and we can't use no outside help." A few minutes before we hit St. Joe, we seen him again, sitting down below, afraid to dance and entirely out of conversation. They was having just as good a time as Jenny's babies. "We're pretty near in," I says, "and 'twas one of the smoothest crossings I ever made."
"They couldn't nobody get sick in weather like this," says Bess.
"No," I says, "but you take a smooth Saturday afternoon, and it generally always means a rough Sunday night." "Ain't they no railroad between here and Chi?" asked Bishop. "Not direct," I says. "You have to go to Lansing and then cut across to Fort Wayne. If you make good connections, you can do it in a day and two nights. But most of the way's through the copper ranges, and the trains keeps getting later and later, and when they try to make up time, they generally always slip off in the track and spill their contents."
"If it looks like a storm tomorrow night," says Bess, "we might wait over and go home Monday."
That idea scared Bishop more than the thought of a wreck. "Oh, no," he says. "I got to be back on the job Monday morning."
"If it's as rough as I think it's going to be," says I, "you won't feel like ripping off no scenarios Monday." We landed and walked up the highest hill in Michigan to the hotel. I noted that Miss Bessie carried her own suitcase. "Well," says I suppose you two kids would rather eat your supper by yourself, and I and the missus would set at another table."
"No, no," says Bess, "it'll be pleasanter to all eat together."
So for about half an hour we had 'em with us, and they'd have stuck the rest of the evening if I'd gave 'em a chance. "What about a little game of cards?" says Bishop when we was through eatin'.
"It's mighty nice of you to suggest it," I says, "but I know you're only doing it for my sake and the wife's. We'll find some way to amuse ourselves, and you and Bess can take a stroll down on the beach."
"The wind made me sleepy," says Bishop. "I believe I'll go up to my room and turn in." "The rooms is not ready," I says. "The clerk'll let us know as soon as we can have 'em." But he didn't take my word, and when he talked to the clerk himself and found out that he could have his room right away, there wasn't no arguing with him. Off he went to bed at 8 p.m., leaving the missus and I to entertain the Belle of Wabash. Sunday morning I added to my investment by hiring a flivver to take us out to the Edgewater Club. "Now," I says, "we'll rent some bathing suits and cool off."
"I don't dast go in," says Bishop. "I'll take more cold. I'll watch the rest of you."
Well, I didn't care whether he went in or not, the water being too shallow along there to drown him, but I did want him to watch the rest of us, one in particular. The suit they gave her was an Annette. I wouldn't make no attempt to describe what she looked like in it, unless it'd be a capital Y that had got turned upside down. She didn't have no displacement, and she could have stayed in it all day without the lake ever finding out she was there. But I cut the film short so I could get 'em back to the hotel and leave the pair together. "You're going to have all the rest of the day to yourself," I told 'em. "We won't eat dinner with you. I and the missus will just disappear and meet you here in the hotel at 7 o'clock tonight."
"Where are you going?" asked Bishop.
"Never you mind," I says.
"Maybe we'd like to go along with you," he says.
"Yes, you would," says I. "Remember, boy, I was in love once myself, and I know I didn't want no third parties hanging around."
"But what can we do all day in this burg?" he says.
"There's plenty to do," I says. "You can go over there and sit on them benches and watch the interurbans come in from South Bend and Niles, or you can hire a boat and go out for a sail, or you can fish for tarpons, or you can take a trolley over to Benton Harbor, or you can sit on the beach and spoon. Nobody minds here. Only be sure you don't sit in somebody's lunch basket, because they say a garlic stain's almost impossible to get out. And there's another thing you might do," I says. "This town's one of these here Gretna Greens. You can get a marriage license in any delicatessen, and the streetcar conductors is authorized to perform the ceremony." They didn't blush when I pulled that. They turned pale, both of 'em, and I seen that I was gonna win, sure. "Come on," I says to the missus, "we must be on our way." We left them before they could stop us and walked across the street and along through the park.
"Where are we headed?" asked the wife.
"I don't know," I says, "but I don't want to spoil their good time."
"I don't believe they're having a good time," she says.
"How could they help it?" says I. "When two true lovers is left alone together, what more could they ask for?"
"There's something wrong with 'em," says the missus. "They act like they was mad at each other, and Bess told me when we was out to the Edgewater Club that she wished we was home."
"That's a fine way for her to talk," I says, "when I'm trying to show her a good time."
"And I overheard Elmer," says the missus, "asking one of the bellboys where he could get something to drink. And the bellboy asked him what kind of drink, and he says, 'Whiskey or poison, it don't make no difference.'
If I was sure he'd take the poison, I'd try to get it for him," I says. On the grass and the benches in the park we seen some of the gang that had come over on the boat with us. They looked like they'd laid there all night, and the kids was crying louder than ever. Besides them, we seen dozens of young couples that was still on speaking terms, because they'd only been together for an hour or two. The girls was wearing nice clean white dresses and white shoes, and was all prettied up. They seemed to be having the time of their life. And by 4 o'clock in the afternoon their fingers would be stuck together with crackerjack, and their dresses decorated with chocolate syrup, and their escorts talking to 'em like a section boss to a gang of hunkies. We wandered around till dinner time, and then dropped into a little restaurant where they give you a whole meal for 35 cents and make a profit of 35 cents. When we'd staggered out under the weight of this repast, a streetcar was standing there that said it would take us to the house of David.
"Come on," I says, and led the missus aboard.
"Where to?" she asked me.
"I don't know," I says, "but it sounds like a roadhouse." It was even better than that. You couldn't get nothing to drink, but there was plenty to see and hear. Band concerts, male and female, moving pictures, a zoo, a bowling alley, and more funny-looking people than I ever seen in an amusement park before. It ain't a regular amusement park, but 50-50 between that and a kind of religious sex that calls itself the Holy Roller Skaters or something. All the men that was old enough to keep a beard had one, and for a minute I thought we'd bumped into the summer home of the people that took part in Ida. There wouldn't nobody have ever mistook the women for Folly's Chorus girls. They looked like they was having a prize contest to see which could dress the homeliest, and if I'd been one of the judges, I'd have split the first prize as many ways as there was women. "I'm going to talk to some of these people," I told the wife.
"What for?" she says.
"Well, for one thing," I says, "I've been talking to one person so long I'm tired of it, and for another thing, I want to find out what the idea of the whole concern is." So we walked up to one of the most flourishing beards, and I braced him. "Who owns this joint?" I says.
"All who have the faith," he says.
"What do they charge a man to join?" I asked him.
"Many's called and few chosen," he says.
"How long have you been here?" I asked him.
"Prove all things and hold fast to what's good," he says. "Why don't you get some of our books and study them?"
He led us over to where they had the books, and I looked at some of them. One was the Flying Roll, and another was the Living Roll of Life, and another was the Rolling Ball of Fire. "If you had some books about coffee, you could make a breakfast on them," I says. Well, we stuck around there till pretty near 6 o'clock, and talked to a lot of different ones, and asked them all kinds of questions. And they answered them all with verses from Scripture that had nothing to do with what we'd asked.
"We got a lot of information. We don't know no more about them now than before we come."
"We know their politics," I says.
"How?" she asked me.
"From the looks of them," I says, "they're unanimous for Hughes." We found Bess all alone, sitting in the lobby of the hotel. "Where's your honeyman?" I asked her. She turned up her nose.
"Don't call him my honeyman or anything else," she says.
"Why, what's the matter?" asked the missus.
"Nothing at all's the matter," she says.
"Maybe just a lover's quarrel," says I.
"No, and no lover's quarrel, neither," says Bess. "They couldn't be no lover's quarrel, 'cause there ain't no lovers."
"You had me fooled then," I says. "I'd have swore that you and Bishop was just like that."
"You made a big mistake," says Bessie. "I never cared nothing for him, and he never cared nothing for me, because he's incapable of caring for anything, only himself."
"Why, Bess," says the missus, "you told me just yesterday morning that you was practically engaged."
"I don't care what I told you," she says, "but I'm telling you something now. I don't never want to hear of him or see him again, and you'll do me a favor if you'll drop the subject."
"But where is he?" I asked her.
"I don't know, and I don't care," she says.
"But I got to find him," I says. "He's my guest."
"You can have him," she says.
I found him up in his room. The bellboy had got him something, and it wasn't poison, neither. At least I haven't never died of it. "Well, Bishop," I says, "finish it up and come downstairs. Bess and the wife will want some supper."
"You'll have to excuse me," he says. "I don't feel like eating a thing."
"But you can come down and set with us," I says. "Bess will be sore if you don't."
"Listen here," he says. "You've took too much for granted. There's nothing between your sister-in-law and I. If you've set your heart on us being something more than friends, I'm sorry, but there's not a chance."
"Bishop," I says, "this is a blow to me. It comes like a shock." And to keep myself from fainting, I took the bottle from his dresser and completed its ruin. "You won't even come down and set with us?" I says.
"No," says Bishop, "and if you don't mind, you can give me my ticket back home, and I'll stroll down to the dock and meet you on the boat."
"Here's your ticket," says I.
"And where am I going to sleep?" he says.
"Well," I says, "I'll get you a stateroom if you really want it, but it's going to be a bad night, and if you was in one of them berths and something happened, you wouldn't have a chance in the world."
"You ain't going to have no berth yourself?" he asked me.
"I should say not," I says. "I'm going to get me a chair and sleep in the watertight compartments." Boys, my prophecy come true. There was more roll on old Lake Michigan that night than in all them books up to the Holy Rollers Skaters Park. And if the boat was filled to capacity, just 1,300 of us was fatally ill. I don't think it was the rolling that got me. It was one glimpse of all the Jennies and all their offsprings, and the wealthy Greek shoeshiners, and the millionaire truck drivers, and the heiress from the lace department, laying hither and thither in the cabins and on the decks, breathing their last. And how they must have felt to think that all their outlay for crackerjack and apples was a total loss. But Bishop wasn't sick. I searched the boat from the back to the stern, and he wasn't aboard. I guess probably he found out some way that there was such an institution as the Père Marquette, which gets into Chicago without touching them perilous copper ranges. But whether he arrived safe or not, I don't know, because I've never saw him again from that day to this, and I've lived happily ever afterward. And my investment, amounting all told of just about what he owes me, turned out even better than I hoped for. Bess went back to Wabash that Monday afternoon. At supper Monday night, which was the first meal the missus could face, she says, "I haven't got it figured out yet. Bess swears they didn't have no quarrel, but I'll take an oath they was in love with each other. What could have happened?"
"I know what happened," I says. "They got acquainted."
End of The Water Cure. Chapter 5 of Gullible's Travels, etc. by Ring Lardner. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Three without, doubled. 1. There ain't no immediate chance of you getting asked out to our house to dinner, not while Round Steak and General Motors is selling at the same price, and Common Dog Biscuits 10 cents a loaf. But you might have nothing decent to do some evening, and happen to drop in on the missus and I for a call. So I feel like I ought to give you a little warning in case that comes off. You know, there's lots of words that's called fightin' words. Some of 'em starts a brawl, no matter who they're spoke to. You can't call nobody a liar without expecting to lose a couple of milk teeth, that is, if the party addressed has got something besides lemon juice in his veins, and ain't had the misfortune to fall asleep on the panhandle tracks and be separated from his most prominent legs and arms. Then there's terms that don't hit you so much yourself, but reflects on your ancestors and prodigies, and you're supposed to resent 'em for the sake of honor and fix the speaker's map so as when he goes home, his wife'll say, "Oh, kiddies, come and look at the rainbow." Then there's other words and terms that you can call 'em to somebody and not get no rise, but call 'em to somebody else, and the insurance companies could hold out on your widow by claiming it was suicide. For instance, there's young Harold Greiner, one of the bookkeepers down to the office. I could tell him he was an APA with a few adjectives, and he'd just smile and say, "Quit your flirting." But I wouldn't never try that expression on Dan Cahill, the elevator starter, without being well out of his earshots. And I don't know what it means at that. Well, if you do come out to the house, there's a term that you want to lay off of when the missus is in the room. Don't say San Susie. It sounds harmless enough, don't it? There ain't nothing to it, even when it's transferred over from the Latin, without no cares. But you just leave her hear it mentioned, and watch her grab the two deadliest weapons that's within reach, one to use on you, or whoever said it, and the other on me, on general principles. You think I'm stringing you? And I admit you got cause, that is, till you've heard the details of our latest plunge in the cesspools of society. 2. It was a Friday evening about 3 weeks ago when I come home and found the wife quavering with excitement.
"Who do you think called up?" she asked me.
"I got no idea," I says.
"Guess,"
says she. So I had to guess. "Josephus Daniels," I says, "or Henry Ford. Or maybe it was that guy with a scar on his lip that you thought was smiling at you the other day."
"You couldn't never guess," she says. "It was Mrs. Messenger."
"Which one?" I asked her. "You can't mean Mrs. A.D.T. Messenger."
"If you're so cute, I won't tell you nothing about it," says she.
"Don't make no rash threats," I says. "You're going to tell me sometime, and there's no use making yourself sick by trying to hold it in."
"You know very well what Mrs. Messenger I mean," she says. "It was Mrs. Robert Messenger. That's husband owns this building and the one at the corner where they live at."
"Haven't you paid the rent?" I says.
"Do you think a woman like Mrs. Messenger would be butting into her husband's business?"
says the missus. "I don't know what kind of woman Mrs. Messenger is," I says, "but if I owned these here apartments and somebody fell behind in their rent, I wouldn't be surprised to see the owner's wife going right over to their flat and taking it out of their trousers pocket."
"Well," says the wife, "we don't owe them no rent, and that wasn't what she called me up about. It wasn't no business call."
"Go ahead and spill it," I says. "My heart's weak."
"Well," she says, "I was just getting through with the lunch dishes, and the phone rang."
"I bet you wondered who it was," says I.
"I thought it was Mrs. Hatch or somebody," says the wife. "So I run to the phone, and it was Mrs. Messenger." So the first thing she says was to explain who she was, just like I didn't know. And the next thing she asked was, did I play bridge?
"And what did you tell her?" says I.
"What do you think I'd tell her?" says the missus. "I told her yes."
"Wasn't you trifling a little with the truth?" I asked her.
"Certainly not," she says. "Haven't I played twice over at Hatch's?" So then she asked me if my husband played bridge too, and I told her yes, he did.
"What was the idea?" I says. "You know I didn't never play it in my life."
"I don't know such a thing," she says. "For all as I know, you may play all day down to the office."
"No," says I. "We spend all our time down there playing post office with the scrub women."
"Well, anyway, I told her you did," says the missus. "Don't you see there wasn't nothing else I could tell her? Because if I told her you didn't, that would have ended it."
"Ended what?" I says.
"We wouldn't have been asked to the party," says the missus.
"Who told you there was gonna be a party?" I says.
"I don't have to be told everything," says the missus. "I got brains enough to know that Mrs. Messenger ain't calling me up and asking me do we play bridge just because she's got a headache or feels lonesome or something. But it ain't only one party after all, and that's the best part of it. She asked us if we'd care to join the club."
"What club?" says I.
"Mrs. Messenger's club, the San Susie Club," says the missus. "You've heard me speak about it 100 times, and it's been mentioned in the papers once or twice, too. Once, anyway, when the members gave away them Christmas dinners last year."
"We can get into the papers," I says, "without giving away no Christmas dinners."
"Who wants to get into the papers?" says the wife. "I don't care nothing about that."
"No," says I. "I suppose if a reporter came out here and asked for your picture to stick in the society columns, you'd pick up the carving knife and run him ragged."
"I'd be polite to him, at least," she says.
"Yes," says I. "It wouldn't pay to treat him rude. It'd even be justifiable to lock him in while you was looking for the picture."
"If you kindly leave me talk, you may find out what I got to say," she says. "I've told you about this club, but I don't suppose you ever paid any attention. It's a club that's made up from people that just lives in this block, 20 of them all together, and all but one couple either lives in this building or in the building the Messengers lives in. And they're all nice people, people with real class to them, not no tramps like most of the ones we've been running around with. One of 'em's Mr. and Mrs. Arthur Collins that used to live on Sheridan Road and still goes over to parties at some of the most exclusive homes on the north side. And they don't have nobody in the club that isn't congenial with each other, but all just a nice crowd of real people that gets together once a week in one of the members' houses and have a good time."
"How did these pillows of society happen to light on to us?" I asked her.
"Well," she says, "it seems the Baileys, who belong to the club, went to California last week to spend the winter. And they had to have a couple to take their place. And Mrs. Messenger says they wouldn't take nobody that didn't live in our block. And her and her husband looked over the list, and we was the ones they picked out."
"Probably," I says, "that's because we was the only eligibles that can go out nights on account of not having no children."
"The Pearsons ain't asked," she says, "and they ain't got no children."
"Well," I says, "what's the dues?"
"'There ain't no dues,' said the missus. "'But once in a while, instead of playing bridge, "'everybody puts in $2 apiece to have a theater party. "'But the regular program is for an evening of bridge "'every Tuesday night at different members' houses, "'somebody different acting as hosts every week. "'And each couple puts up $2, "'making $10 for a gent's prize and $10 for a lady's. "'And the prizes is picked out by the lady "'that happens to be the hostess.'
"'That's a swell proposition for me,' I says. "'In the first place, there wouldn't be a chance in the world for me to win a prize, "'cause I don't know nothing about the game. "'And in the second place, suppose I had a whole lot of luck and did win the prize, "'and come to find out it was a silver mustache cup "'that I wouldn't have no more use for than another Adam's apple. "'If they paid in cash, there might be something to it.'
"'If you win a prize, you can sell it, can't you?' says the missus. "'Besides, the prizes don't count.' It's getting in with the right kind of people that makes the difference.
Another thing, I says, when it comes our turn to have the party, where would we stick 'em all? We'd have to spread a sheet over the bathtub for one table and have one couple set on the edges and the other couple toss up for the wash basin and the clothes hamper. And another two couple would have to kneel around the bed, and another bunch could stand up around the bureau. That'd leave the dining room table for the fourth set, and for a special treat, the remaining four could play in the parlor.
"'We could hire chairs and tables,' says the missus. "'We're going to have to sometime, anyway, when you or I die.'
"'You don't need to hire no tables for my funeral,' I says. "'If the pallbearers of the quartet insists on shooting craps, "'they can use the kitchen floor. "'Or if they want beer and sandwiches, "'you can slip 'em the money to go down to the corner.'
"'There's no use worrying about our end of it yet,' says the wife. "'We'll be new members, and they won't expect us to give no party "'till everybody else has had their turn.'
"'I only got one objection left,' I says. "'How am I going to get by at a bridge party "'when I haven't no idea how many cards to deal?'
"'I guess you can learn if I learned,' she says. "'You're always talking about what a swell card player you are. "'And besides, you've played whist, and ain't hardly any difference.'
"'And the next party is next Tuesday night,' I says.
"'Yes,' says the missus, "'at Mrs. Garrett's, the best player in the club, "'and one of the smartest women in Chicago, Mrs. Messenger says.' "'She lives at the same building with the messengers, "'and they's dinner first, and then we play bridge all evening.
"'And maybe,' I says, "'before the evening's over, I'll find out what's trumps.'
"'You'll know all about the game before that,' she says. "'Right after supper, we'll get out the cards, and I'll show you.'
"'So right after supper, she got out the cards and began to show me. "'But about all as I learnt was one thing, "'and that was if I died without no insurance, "'the missus would stand a better show of supporting herself "'by umpiring baseball in the National League "'than by teaching in a bridge whist university. "'She knew everything except about how much the different suits counted "'and how many points was in a game, "'and what honors meant, and who done the first bidding, "'and how much to bid on what. "'After about an hour of it, I says, "'I can see you got this thing mastered. But you're like a whole lot of other people that knows something perfect themselves, but can't learn it to nobody else.
No, she says, I got to admit that I don't know as much as I thought I did. I didn't have no trouble when I was playing with Mrs. Hatch and Mrs. Pearson and Mrs. Kramer, but it seems like I forgot all they learnt me.
It's a crime, I says, that we should have to pass up this chance to get in right, just because we can't play a fool game of cards. "'Why don't you call up Mrs. Messenger "'and suggest that the San Susie switches to Pedro "'or 500 or Rummy "'or something that you don't need "'to take no college course in?'
"'You're full of brilliant ideas,' says the missus. "'There's only just the one game the society plays, "'and that's bridge. "'Them other games is jokes.'
"'I have noticed you always treated 'em that way,' I says, "'but they wasn't so funny to me when it came time to settle.'
"'I'll tell you what we'll do,' says the missus. "'We'll call up Mr. and Mrs. Hatch "'and tell them to come over here tomorrow night "'and give us a lesson.'
"'That'd be sweet,' I says, "'asking them to learn us a game "'so as we could join a club that's right here in their neighborhood, "'but they ain't even been asked to join it.'
"'Why, you rummy,' she says. "'We don't have to tell them why we want to learn.' We just say that my two attempts over to their house has got me interested, and I and you want to master the game so as we can spend many pleasant evenings with them, because Mrs. Hatch has told me 100 times that her and her husband would rather play bridge than eat.
So she called up Mrs. Hatch and sprung it on her. But it seemed like the Hatches had an engagement for Saturday night, but would be tickled to death to come over Monday evening and give us a workout. After that was fixed, we both felt kind of ashamed of ourselves, deceiving people that was supposed to be our best friends. But anyway, the missus says, the Hatches would never fit in with that crowd. Jim always looks like he'd dressed on the elevated, and Mrs. Hatch can't talk about nothing only chiropody. On the Saturday, I tried to slip one over by buying a book called Auction Bridge, and I read it all the way home from town and then left it on the car. It was a great book for a man that had learned the rudiments, and I wanted to find out how to play the game right. But for me to try and get something out of it was just as though some kid had learned the baseball guide by heart in kindergarten and then asked Hugh Jennings for the job in center field. I did find out one thing from it, though. It says that in every deal, one of the players was a dummy and just laid his cards down and left somebody else play 'em. So when I got home, I says, we won't need no help from Jim Hatch and his wife. We can just be dummies all the evening, and they won't nobody know if we're ignorant or not.
That's impossible to be dummy all the time, says the missus.
Not for me, I says. I know it'll be tough for you, but you can chew a lot of gum and you won't mind it so much.
You don't understand, she says. The dummy is the partner of the party that gets the bid. Suppose one of the people that was playing against you got the bid. Then the other one would be dummy, and you'd have to play your hand.
But I don't need to leave them have the bid, I says. I can take it away from them.
And if you take it away from them, she says, then you got the bid yourself, and your partner's dummy, not you.
Well, the Hatches breezed in Monday night, and Mrs. Hatch remarked how tickled she was that we was going to learn and what good times we four'd have playing together, and the missus and I pretended like we shared her raptures.
Ain't you never played at all?
She asked me, and I told her no.
The first thing, she says, is how much the different suits counts, and then they's the bids, and you got to pay attention to the conventions.
I'm through with them forever, I says, since they turned down Roosevelt. Well, we started in, and Hatch and the missus played Mrs. Hatch and I. We kept at it till pretty near midnight, with three or four intermissions so as Hatch could relieve the strain on the icebox. My whist education kept me from being much of a flivver when it came to playing the cards, but I don't care how bright a guy is, you just can't learn everything about bidding in one evening, and you can't remember half what you learned. I don't know what the score was when we got through, but the Hatches done most of the execution and held most of the cards, which is their regular habit.
You'll get along all right, says Mrs. Hatch when they was ready to go. But of course you can't expect to master a game like bridge in a few hours. You want to keep at it.
We're going to, says the missus.
Maybe it'd be a good idea, says Mrs. Hatch, to play again soon before you forget what we learnt you. Why don't you come over to our house for another session tomorrow night?
Let's see, tomorrow night, says the missus, stallin'. Why, no, we can't. We got an engagement. So Mrs. Hatch stood there like she was expecting to hear what it was.
We're going to a party, says the wife. Oh, tell me about it, says Mrs. Hatch. Well, says the missus, it ain't really a party. It's just kind of a party. Some old friends that's visiting in town. Maybe they'll play bridge with you, says Mrs. Hatch.
Oh, no, says the missus, blushing. It'll probably be Rummy or Pedro, or maybe we'll just go to the pictures.
Why don't you go over to the Acme, says Mrs. Hatch. They got Chaplin in the street sweeper. We're going, and we could meet you and all go together.
No, says the wife. You see, one of our friends has just lost his wife, and I know he wouldn't feel like going to see something funny.
He's already laughed himself sick, I says.
Well, we wouldn't make no date with them, and they finally blew, with the understanding that we was to go to their house and play some night soon. When they'd went, the missus says,
I feel like a criminal deceiving them like that, but I just couldn't tell them the truth. Bertha Hatch is the most jealous thing in the world, and it would just about kill her to know that we was in on something good without she and Jim.
If you hadn't asked him over, I says, we'd have been just as well off, and you wouldn't have had to make a perjure out of yourself.
What do you mean we'd have been just as well off, she says? They done what we expected of them, learn us the game.
Yes, I says, and you could take all I remember of the lesson and feed it to a gnat, and he'd say, hurry up with the soup course. 3. Well, Mrs. Garrett had called up to say that the feed before the game would begin at 7 bells, so I and the missus figured on being on hand at 6:30 so as to get acquainted with some of our fellow club members and know what to call 'em when we wanted the gravy passed or something. But I had trouble with my studs, and it wasn't till pretty near 7:20 that we rung the Garrett's bell. The hired girl let us in and left us standing in the hall while she went to tell Mrs. Garrett we was there. Pretty soon the girl come back and says she would take our wraps and that Mrs. Garrett would be with us in a few minutes. So we were showed into the living room. The apartment was on the 2nd floor and looked about twice as big as ourn.
"What do you suppose this costs 'em?" asked the missus.
"About 55 a month," I says.
"You're crazy," says she. "They got this big living room and 2 bedrooms and a maid's room and a sun parlor, besides their dining room and kitchen and bath. They're lucky if they ain't stuck for 70.
"I'll bet you," I says. "I'll bet you it's nearer 55 than 70.
"How much will you bet?" she says.
"Anything you say," says I.
"Well," she says, "I've got a cinch, and I need a pair of black silk stockings. My others has begun to run."
"All right," I says, "a pair of black silk stockings to 50 cents cash."
"You're on," she says, "and I'll call up the agent tomorrow and find out."
Well, it must have been pretty near 7 o'clock when Mrs. Garrett finally showed up.
"Good evening," she says. "I suppose this must be our new members. I'm awfully glad you could come, and I'm sorry I wasn't quite ready."
"That's all right," I says. "I'm glad to know these others has trouble getting into their evening clothes. I suppose people that does it often enough finally gets to be experts."
"I didn't have no trouble," says Mrs. Garrett, "only I didn't expect nobody till 7 o'clock. You must have misunderstood me and thought I said 6:30.
Then Mr. Garrett came in and shook hands with us, and then the rest of the folks began to arrive, and we was introduced to them all. I didn't catch all of their names, only Mr. and Mrs. Messenger, and Mr. and Mrs. Collins, and a Mr. and Mrs. Sparks. Mrs. Garrett says dinner was ready, and I was glad to hear it. They set me down between Mrs. Messenger and a lady that I didn't get her name. "Well," I says to Mrs. Messenger, "now we know you personally, we can pay the rent direct without bothering to go to the real estate office."
"I'm afraid that wouldn't do," she says. "Our agent's entitled to his commissions, and besides, I wouldn't know how much to take or nothing about it."
"We pay 35, I says, "and that's all as you could ask for, seeing as we only got the 4 rooms and no sun parlor. 32 1/2 would be about the right price."
"You'll have to argue that with our agent," she says.
I was kind of expecting a cocktail, but nothing doing. The hired girl brought in some half sandwiches made of toast with something on 'em that looked like BB shot and tasted like New Year's morning. "Don't we get no liquid refreshments?" I asked Mrs. Messenger.
"No, indeed," she says. "The San Susie's a dry club."
"You should ought to call it the San Sousy, then," says I. The missus was sitting next to Mr. Garrett, and I could hear 'em talking about what a nice neighborhood it was and how they liked their flats. I thought I and the missus might as well settle our bet right then and there, so I spoke to Mr. Garrett across the table. "Mr. Garrett," I says, "while we was waiting for you and your wife to get dressed, I and the missus made a little bet, a pair of silk stockings against 50 cents. I got to pay out $2 here for the prize, and the missus claims her other stockings has begun to run, so you might say we're both a little anxious."
"Is it something I can settle?" he asked.
"Yes, sir," I says, "because we was betting on the rent you paid for this apartment. The missus says 70 a month, and I says 55.
"I never decide against a lady," he says. "You better buy the stockings before the others run so far they can't find their way home."
"If I lose, I lose," says I, "but if you're stuck 65 or better, the missus must have steered me wrong about the number of rooms you got. I'll pay, though, because I don't ever welch on a bet, so this party's really costing me 2 1/2 instead of 2.
"Maybe you'll win the prize," says Mr. Garrett.
"There ain't much chance," I says. "I ain't never played this game for a long while."
"Why, your wife was just telling me you played last night," he says.
"I mean," says I, "that I didn't play for a long while before last night. Not for 36 years, I says. "Well, when everybody got through choking down the shot, They brought in some drowned toadstools, and then some little slices of beef about the size of a checker, and 7 Saratoga chips apiece, and 6 string beans. Those that was still able to set up under this load finished off on sliced tomatoes that was caught too young, and a nickel's worth of ice cream and an eyedropper full of coffee.
"Before I forget it," says Mrs. Collins, while we was staggering out of the dining room, "you're all coming to my house next Tuesday night."
I was walking right behind her. "And I got a suggestion for you," I says, low enough so as they couldn't nobody else hear. "Throw in some of the prize money into the dinner, and if there's any skimping to be done, do it on the prizes." She didn't say nothing back, because Mrs. Garrett had started to hand us the little cards that showed us where we was to play.
"I suppose I better tell you our rules," she says to me. "Each table plays 4 deals. Then the winners moves while the losers set still, except at the first table, where the winners set still and the losers moves. You change partners after every 4 deals. You count 50 for a game and 150 for a rubber."
"The way I've been playing," I says, "it was 30 for a game."
"I never heard of that," she says,
"but I noticed when we got to playing that everybody that made 30 points called it a game." "Don't we see the prizes before we start?" I asked her. "I want to know whether to play my best or not."
"If you win the prize and don't like it," she says, "I guess you can get it exchanged."
"They tell me you're the shark amongst the women folks," says I, "so it's a safe bet that you didn't pick out no ladies' prize that isn't okay." I noticed some of the other men was slipping her their ante, so I parted with a 2-spot. Then I found where I was to set at. It was table number 3, couple number 1. My partner was a strapping big woman with a name something like Rowley or Phillips. Our opponents was Mrs. Garrett and Mr. Messenger. Mrs. Garrett looked like she'd been living on the kind of a meal she'd gave us, and Mr. Messenger could have sat in the back seat of a flivver with 2 regular people without crowding nobody. So I says to my partner, "Well, partner, we got 'em outweighed anyway." There was 2 decks of cards on the table. I grabbed 1 of 'em and began to deal 'em face up. "First Jack," I says.
"If you don't mind, we'll cut for deal," says Mrs. Garrett.
So we cut the cards, and it seemed like the low cut got the deal, and that was Mrs. Garrett herself. "Which deck'll we play with?" I asked.
"Both of them," says Mrs. Garrett. "Mr. Messenger'll make them red ones for you."
"Make 'em," I says. "Well, Messenger, I didn't know you was a card factory." Messenger laughed, but the 2 ladies didn't get it. Mrs. Garrett dealt, and it was her turn to bid.
"1 without," she says.
"I'd feel better if I had 1 within," says I.
"Are you going to bid or not?" she asked me.
"I thought it was the dealer's turn first," I says.
"I've made my bid," she says. "I bid 1 without."
"1 without looking, or what?" I says.
"1 no trump, if I've got to explain it," she says.
"Oh, that's different," I says. But I found out that most all of 'em said 1 without when they meant 1 no trump. I looked at my hand, but about all as I had was 4 hearts with the king and jack high. "Partner," I says, "I don't see nothing I can bid unless it be 1 heart. Does that hit you?"
"No talking across the boards," says Mrs. Garrett, "and besides, 1 heart ain't over my bid."
So I passed, and Mr. Messenger bid 2 spades. Then my partner passed, and Mrs. Garrett thought it over a while, and then bid 2 without. So I passed again, and the rest of them passed, and it was my first lead. Well, I didn't have only 1 spade, the 8 spot, and I knew it wouldn't do my hand no good as long as I couldn't trump in with it, so I let it out. Messenger was dummy, and he laid his hand down. He had about 8 spades with an ace and queen high.
"I might as well take a chance,"
says Mrs. Garrett, and she throwed on Messenger's 10 spot. Out come my partner with a king, and it was our trick.
"What kind of a lead was that?"
says Mrs. Garrett to me. "Pretty good one, I guess," says I. "It fooled you, anyway." And she acted like she was sore as a boil. Come to find out, she thought I was leading from the king and was going to catch it later on. Well, her and Messenger took all the rest of the tricks except my king of hearts, and they had a game on us, besides 40 for their 4 aces.
"I could have made a little slam as well as not," she says when it was over, "but I misunderstood our friend's lead.
It's the first time I ever seen a man lead from a sneak and no trump.
I'll do a whole lot of things you never seen before, I says.
I don't doubt it,
says she, still acting like I'd spilled salad dressing on her skirt. It was my first bid next time, and hearts was my only suit again. I had the ace, queen, and three others. Pardner, I says, I'm going to bid one heart, and if you got something to help me out with, don't let him take it away from me.
I'll double a heart, says Messenger.
Oh, somebody else is getting cute, says I. Well, I'll double right back at you.
Will you just wait until it comes your turn,
says Mrs. Garrett, and besides, you can't redouble.
I guess I can, says I. I got five of them.
It's against our rules, she says.
So my partner done nothing, as usual, and Mrs. Garrett bid one without again. I guess you want to play 'em all, I says, but you got to come higher'n that. I'm going to bid two hearts.
Two no trump, says Messenger, and my partner says pass once more.
You'll get a sore throat saying that, I told her. Don't you ever hold nothing?
It don't look like it, she says.
Maybe you don't know what's worth bidding on, I says.
Maybe she'd better take a few lessons from you, says Mrs. Garrett.
No, I says, kidding her. You don't want no more female experts in the club, or you might have to buy some cut glass once in a while instead of winning it. Well, I bid three hearts, but Mrs. Garrett come up to three no trump, and I couldn't go no higher. This time I let out my ace of hearts, hoping maybe to catch their king, but I didn't get it. And Mrs. Garrett copped all the rest of 'em for a little slam.
If your husband ever starts drinking hard, I says, you can support yourself by selling some of your horseshoes to the Russian government. It was no lie, neither. I never seen such hands as that woman held, and Messenger's was pretty near as good. In the four deals, they grabbed two rubbers and a couple of little slams, and when they left our table, they had over 900 to our nothing. Mr. Collins and another woman was the next ones to set down with us. The rules was to change partners, and Collins took the one I'd been playing with. And what does she do but get lucky? And then they give us another tribbin, though nothing near as bad as the first one. My partner this time was a woman about 48, and she acted like it was way past her bedtime. When it was her turn to say something, we always had to wait about 5 minutes, and all the other tables was through a long while before us. Once she says,
"You'll have to excuse me tonight. I don't somehow seem to be able to keep my mind on the game."
"No," I says, "but I bet you'd perk up if the lady's prize was a mattress. When you're going to be up late, you should ought to take a nap in the afternoon." Well, sir, my next partner wasn't nobody else but the missus. She'd started at the fourth table and lost the first time, but win the second. She'd come along with the husband of the partner I'd just had, so here we was, family against family, you might say.
"What kind of luck you been having?" the fellow asked me.
"No luck at all," I says, "but if you're anywhere near as sleepy as your missus, I and my wife ought to clean up this time." We didn't. They held all the cards except in one hand, and that was the one my missus tried to play. I bid first and made it a no-trump, as there was three aces in my hand. Old Slumber began to talk in her sleep and says, "Two diamonds." The missus bid two hearts. Mr. Sleeper passed, and so did I, as I didn't have a single heart in my hand and figured the missus probably had 'em all. She had six, with the king high and then the nine spot. Our female opponent only had two, and that left five for her husband, including the ace, queen, and jack. We was set three.
"Nice work," I says to the missus. "You're the Philadelphia Athletics of Auction Bridge."
"What was you bidding no trump on?" she says. "I thought, of course, you'd have one high heart and some suit."
"You don't want to start thinking at your age," I says. "You can't learn an old dog new tricks."
Mrs. Knapp's husband cut in.
"Of course," he says, "it's a man's privilege to call your wife anything you feel like calling her, but your missus don't hardly look old to me."
"No, not comparatively speaking," I says, and he shut up. They moved on, and along come Garrett and Mrs. Messenger. I and Mrs. Messenger was partners, and I thought for a while we was going to win. But Garrett and the missus had a bouquet of four-leaf clovers in the last two deals and licked us. Garrett wasn't supposed to be as smart as his wife, but he was fox enough to keep bidding over my missus so as he'd do the playing instead of she. It wasn't till pretty near the close of the evening's entertainment that I got away from that table and moved to number two. When I sat down there, it was I and Mrs. Collins against her husband and Mrs. Sleeper. "Well, Mrs. Collins," I says, "I'll try and hold some good hands for you, and maybe I can have two helpings of the meat when we come to your house." The other lady opened her eyes long enough to ask who was winning.
"Oh, Mrs. Garrett's way ahead," says Mrs. Collins. "She's got a score of something like 3,000, and Mr. Messenger is high amongst the men."
"Who's next to the leading lady?" I asked her.
"I guess I am," she says, "but I'm 300 behind Mrs. Garrett."
Well, the luck I just bumped into stayed with me, and I and Mrs. Collins won and moved to the head table. Waiting there for us was our darling hostess and Messenger, the two leaders in the pennant race. It was give out that this was to be the last game. When Mrs. Garrett realized who was going to be her partner, I wished you could have seen her face.
"This is an unexpected pleasure," she says to me. "I thought you liked the third table so well you was going to stay there all evening."
"I did intend to," I says, "but I seen you up here, and I heard you was leading the league, so I thought I'd like to help you finish in front."
"I don't need no help," she says. "All I ask is for you to not overbid your hands, and I'll do the rest." "How many are you, Mrs. Garrett?" asked Mrs. Collins. 3,260, she says. "Oh, my," says Mrs. Collins, "I'm hopeless. I'm only 2,948. And how about you, Mr. Messenger?"
"Round 3,100, he says.
"Yes," says Mrs. Garrett, "and I don't believe any of the rest of the men is within 500 of that."
"Well, Messenger," I says, "if the men's prize happens to be a case of beer or a steak smothered in onions, don't forget that I'm paying you $35 a month for a $30 flat." Well, I'd have given my right eye to see Mrs. Collins beat Mrs. Garrett out. But I was going to do my best for Mrs. Garrett just the same, because I don't think it's square for a man not to try and play your hardest all the time in any kind of a game, no matter where your sympathies lays. So when it came my turn to bid on the first hand, and I seen the ace and king and four other hearts in my hand, I raised Mrs. Collins' bid of 2 diamonds, and Mrs. Garrett made it a 2-0 trump and got away with it. On the next 2 deals, Messenger and Mrs. Collins made a game, and Mrs. Garrett got set a trick once on a bid of 5 clubs. The way the score was when it came to the last deal, I figured that if Mrs. Collins and Messenger made another game and rubber, the two women would be mighty close to even. Mrs. Garrett dealt him and says,
"One without."
"Two spades," says Mrs. Collins. Well, sir, there wasn't a spade in my hand, and I seen that if Mrs. Collins got it, we was ruined on account of me not having a trump. And while I wanted Mrs. Collins to win, I was going to do my best to not let her. So I says, 2 without.
"You know what you're doing, do you?" says Mrs. Garrett.
"What do you mean, know what I'm doing?" I says. "Not talking across the boards," says Messenger.
"All right," I says, "but you can depend on me, partner, not to throw you down." Well, Messenger passed, and so did Mrs. Garrett, but Mrs. Collins wasn't through.
3 spades, she says.
3 without, says I.
"I hope it's all right," says Mrs. Garrett.
"I'll tell you one thing," I says, "it's a whole lot all righter than if she played it in spades."
Messenger passed again, and ditto for my partner.
"I'll double,"
says Mrs. Collins, and we let it go at that.
Man, oh man, you ought to seen our genial hostess when I laid down my cards. And heard her, too, her face all 3 colors of old glory. She slammed her hand down on the table face up.
"I won't play it," she hollers. "I won't be made a fool of. This poor idiot deliberately told me he had spades stopped, and look at his hand."
"You're mistaken, Mrs. Garrett," I says. "I didn't say nothing about spades."
"Shut your mouth. That's what you ought to have done all evening."
"I might as well have," I says, "for all the good it done me to keep it open at dinner."
Everybody in the room quit playing and rubbered. Finally, Garrett got up from where he was sitting and come over.
"What seems to be the trouble?" he says. "This ain't no bar room."
"Nobody had ever suspected of being," I says.
"Look at what he done," says Mrs. Garrett. "He raised my no-trump bid over 3 spades without a spade in his hand."
Well, says Mr. Garrett, there's no use getting all fussed up over a game of cards. The thing to do is pick up your hand and play it out and take your medicine.
I can set her three, says Mrs. Collins. I got seven spades with the ace, king, and queen, and I'll catch her jack on the third lead.
And I got the ace of hearts, says Messenger. Even if I didn't take a trick, it'd make aces easy. So our 300 above the line gives Mrs. Collins a score of about 10 more than Mrs. Garrett. All right, then, says Garrett. Mrs. Collins is entitled to the lady's prize.
I don't want to take it, says Mrs. Collins.
You got to take it, says Garrett. And he gave his wife a look that meant business. Anyway, she got up and went out of the room. And when she came back, she was smiling. She had two packages in her hand, and she gave one to Messenger and one to Mrs. Collins.
There's the prizes, she says, and I hope you'll like them.
Messenger unwrapped his'n, and it was one of them round leather cases that you use to carry extra collars in when you're traveling. Messenger had told me earlier in the evening that he hadn't been outside of Chicago in 6 years. Mrs. Collins' prize was a chafing dish. I don't blame Mrs. Garrett for her being so crazy to win it, I says to her when they couldn't nobody hear. Her and Garrett both must get hungry about 9 or 10 p.m.
I hate to take it, says Mrs. Collins.
I wouldn't feel that way, I says. I guess Mrs. Garrett will chafe enough without it. When we was ready to go, I shook hands with the host and hostess and says I was sorry if I'd pulled a boner.
It was to be expected, says Mrs. Garrett.
Yes, I says, a man's liable to do most anything when he's starving to death. The Messengers and Collinses was a little ways ahead of us on the stairs, and I wanted we should hurry and catch up with them.
You let them go, says the missus. You've spoiled everything now, without doing nothing more. Every time you talk, you insult somebody.
I ain't going to insult them, I says. I'm just going to ask them to go down to the corner and have a drink.
You are not, she says.
But she's just as good a prophet as she is a bridge player. They wouldn't go along, though, saying it was late and they wanted to get to bed. Well, if you won't, you won't, says I. We'll see you all a week from tonight. And don't forget, Mrs. Collins, that I'm responsible for you winning that chafing dish, and I'm fond of Welch rabbits. I was glad that we didn't have to go far to our building. The missus was pleasant company, just like a bloodhound with a rabies. I left her in the vestibule and went down to help Mike close up. He likes to be amongst friends at a sad hour like that. At breakfast the next morning, the wife was more calm.
"Dearie," she says, "they don't neither one of us class as bridge experts. I'll admit I got a lot to learn about the game. What we want to do is play with the hatches every evening this week, and maybe by next Tuesday night we'll know something."
"I'm willing," I says.
"I'll call Mrs. Hatch up this forenoon," she says, "and see if they want us to come over there this evening. But if we do go, remember not to mention our club or tell them anything about the party."
Well, she had news for me when I got home.
"The San Susie's is busted up," she says. "Not forever, but for a few months, anyway. Mrs. Messenger called up to tell me."
"What's the idea?" I says.
"I don't know exactly," says the missus. "Mrs. Messenger says that the Collinses had boxes for the opera every Tuesday night, and the rest didn't feel like going on without the Collinses, and they couldn't all of them agree on another night."
"I don't see why they should bust it up on account of one couple," I says. "Why don't you tell them about the Hatches? They're right here in the neighborhood and can play bridge as good as anybody."
"I wouldn't think of doing it," says she. "They may play all right, but think of how they'll talk, how they'll dress."
"Well," I says, "between you and I ain't going to take cyanide over a piece of news like this. Somehow it don't appeal to me to vote myself dry every Tuesday night all winter, to say nothing of $2 a week annual dues to help buy a prize that I got no chance of winning and wouldn't know what to do with if I had it."
"It'd be kind of nice, though," she says, "to make friends with them people."
"Well," I says, "I feel a whole lot more confident of doing that if I see them once a year, or not at all." 4. I can tell you the rest of it in about a minute. The missus had become resigned, and everything was going along smooth until last Tuesday evening. There was a new chaplain show over to the Acme, and we was on our way to see it. At the entrance to the building where the Messengers lives, we see Mr. and Mrs. Hatch.
"Hello there," says the wife. "Better come along with us to the Acme."
"Not tonight," says Mrs. Hatch. "We're tied up every Tuesday evening."
"Some club?" asks the missus.
"Yes," says Mrs. Hatch, "it's a bridge club, the San Susi. The Messengers and Collinses and Garretts and us and some other people's in it. 2 weeks ago we was to the Collinses, and last week to Beardsley's, and tonight the Messengers is the hosts."
The missus tried to say something and couldn't.
"I've been awful lucky," says Mrs. Hatch. "I won the prize at Collins's. It was a silver pitcher, the prettiest you ever seen."
The missus found her voice. "Do you have dinner, too?" she asked.
"I should say we do," says Mrs. Hatch, "and simply grand stuff to eat. It was nice last week at Beardsley's, but you ought to have been at Collins's. First there was an old-fashioned beefsteak supper, and then when we was through playing, Mrs. Collins made us Welch rabbits in her chafing dish."
"That don't tempt me," I says. "I'd as soon try and eat a raw muskrat as a Welch rabbit."
"Well, we got to be going in," says Hatch.
"Good night," says Mrs. Hatch, "and I wished you was coming with us."
The picture we saw was called The Fly Cop. Don't never waste a dime on it. There ain't a laugh in the whole show. End of Three Without Doubled. End of Gullible's Travels, etc. by Ring Lardner. Recording by Winston Tharp.